highest risk situations are intense conditioning sessions rather than competitions. Conditions that might increase your risk for complications during intense exercise include a the highest risk situations are intense conditioning sessions rather than competitions. Conditions that might increase your risk for complications during intense exercise include a significant and sudden increase in exercise intensity, a lack of acclimatization before starting intense exercise bouts, experiencing distress while at altitude, in the heat, or poorly hydrated, exercising with acute illness such as with the fever, drug, alcohol, or stimulant use.
So if an athlete is sickle cell trait positive, they can take certain precautions. Those include primarily staying hydrated. So in studies that they've done with sickle cell trait athletes, they've shown that when somebody remains hydrated, their blood cells don't sickle. So somebody who remains hydrated, drinks a lot of fluid, they're going to be at the exact same risk as somebody who doesn't have sickle cell trait. The other thing that athletes need to think about is when they're exercising in the heat. Exercise in the heat puts an extra strain on the body. And so that's when the athlete with sickle cell trait needs to think about, again, staying extra hydrated, really listening to their body, and getting out of the heat, being well conditioned. So you shouldn't go from being not conditioned at all to exercising at full bore, so gradually condition and work your way up. These are all things that the athlete with sickle cell trait needs to think about.
Although all student athletes must receive education regarding sickle cell trait status, you may waive the requirement that your college or university confirm your sickle cell trait status and decline any test administered for that purpose. However, student athletes who waive confirmation must be provided additional education regarding sickle cell trait. Additionally, if you decline the test to determine your sickle cell status, you will be asked to sign a waiver by your college or university. By signing a waiver, you will agree to voluntarily give up any legal rights you may have, including the right to sue your college or university and the NCAA as a result of injuries you may suffer as a result of sickle cell trait. You should only sign the waiver once you fully understand the risks of sickle cell trait and are willing to surrender your legal rights in the event you suffer an injury caused by sickle cell trait.
To reduce the risk of a collapse, all exercising individuals, including those with known sickle cell trait, should be counseled to hydrate sufficiently, acclimatize gradually to heat, humidity, and altitude, condition carefully and gradually for up to several weeks before engaging in exhaustive exercise regimens. Do not exercise at a level significantly higher than current conditioning level. Refrain from extreme exercise during or while recovering from an illness, especially one involving fever. Report your illnesses, injuries, and the use of medications and nutritional supplements. Refrain from consuming high caffeine energy drinks and other stimulants, especially during exercise, as they can mask fatigue and make you exceed workout thresholds. Immediately stop exercise and seek prompt medical care when experiencing unusual physical distress. Knowledge of sickle cell trait status can be a gateway to taking simple precautions that may prevent exercise collapse and allow for optimal performance. Do you know your sickle cell trait status?
Us as a university don't have a waiver, so everybody is required to get their sickle cell test done prior to the start of competition. We'll kind of go over that when we go over our policies, but if they do come to campus, and they don't have a sickle cell test, then we will do that for them, but they cannot practice or do any team activities until that result comes in, which can take, depending on when it goes out, 5 to 7 days, so. All right, if you guys haven't passed in the white forms, the sickle cell acknowledgement, the concussion acknowledgement, if you could fill those out, and then Bree will come around and collect them. And then I'll let Dr. O'Cragley with his presentation talk a little bit more specifically about concussions and how us as a department handles them. So we're not going to go into it right now. Is Chief here or no?
He's not here yet.
Okay. Yeah, I'll switch that if you want to put this on.
Great. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Good. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Is it on already?
Yes.
Okay, good. Good morning.
You guys run a whole athletic department on these few coaches. This is just pretty amazing. Is he here now? Should we switch? You good?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Good. You get to hear about wellness strategies as well. Good. So I think most of you know me. I'm a sports psychologist, performance psychologist. I've been working with consulting with XU for a long time. I had talked to a couple of your coaches. Dave had talked about me doing it, talking about a case study. I decided to kind of weave this in for all of you to have some wellness strategies as well. There's a lot of information on burnout that's come out. Can you guys hear me okay with this? A lot with burnout and stress. Do some of you feel stressed during the season at all? A little bit? Yeah, okay. Yeah, so I thought I'd talk about this, but I want to keep this informal. Please ask questions as we go, and I want to do a little relaxation exercise with you too. But this is some of the stuff I do with your kids anyway, so I thought it would be great to be able to talk about some of this stuff. So in terms of optimal wellness, we're all trying to get to this place where our mind, body, and energy is operating in, you know, in full capacity to the best of our abilities and talents, trying to strategize to live life above zero with energy and enthusiasm. How many of you feel that way most of the time, I think? Some percentage of time, hopefully? Yeah, all right. So when we talk about coping in general, and I'm thinking again for yourselves and for your athletes, ineffective coping, obviously stressors are heavy, fewer resources, and when we have effective coping, we have an equal amount of resources and stressors. Stress is not going to go away for sure, but in order to be able to cope effectively, we have to be able to have the resources we need. So stress defined as a non-specific response to a demanding or threatening event. It's just a state of mental or emotional strain or tension resulting from adverse or very demanding circumstances. Again, it's when we don't have enough resources, we feel a little overwhelmed. Have you found that coaches, I mean not coaches, but the athletes are more stressed than you've seen in the past? Yeah, and some of you, some not? Yeah. So stress is everywhere, it's not gonna go away. We wouldn't really want it to go away anyway, so stress, there could be something with good stress in order to be able to get up in the morning. So we wanna make sure that we just manage it well. So there's a time and place for reacting. If we stay super stressed, we're gonna stay in this caveman mode. Misperceiving potential threats, feeling irritable, staying on survival mode and kind of feeling ready to pounce. So if you can identify that for yourself. So stress response in general, this is all with the HPA axis, and this all starts with our hypothalamus and our perceived idea that there's some stress, so it's all perceived stress to begin with. So again, it originates there. Quieting the hypothalamus can reduce the stress response. I'm going to talk about just some coping strategies in just a second, but all these things drive. So as soon as we perceive a threat or a stress that's going on, whether it's a negative thought or an anxiety response, Your breath gets really shallow, which we've talked about before with breathing. Breath gets shallow, we contract muscle fibers somewhere in our bodies, and depending on where you hold stress, and then about as soon as your brain picks up that you're stressed, about 20 physiological changes happen in your body. So what I find, and I think most of you around when I did that breathing thing? So with the biofeedback machine, I mean, ironically, we never even got that up and running here, but you guys have it here, which is, yeah. So I still see your athletes for that. But it's interesting. Again, it's such a simple thing. It's portable and free. We have this breath with us all the time and this specific type of breathing. It's amazing with your athletes, men and women, how much it changes their approach to their sport because they're finally relaxed, knowing how to relax. So in general, when we think about stress hormones, we want to be able to, we're gonna react to stress. And then the idea over time is that we're coming back to this recovery, right? So one of the problems that's happening for a lot of people with stress, because we have a lot of other perceived stressors that we didn't used to have, our body's kind of staying in this fight or flight mode. So we start losing resiliency, which is the big problem with stress, and we get this severe loss of resiliency. So it puts us at risk for injuries, it puts us at risk for disease-oriented kind of things, a lot of autoimmune dysfunction. So we want to make sure that we recover. We're going to be able to put some parameters in place to be able to get to this place. So the key thing is focusing on self-care. And I'm hoping that all of you have great self-care. I think it's really easy to get away from that. But my philosophy is it's your oxygen mask on first. If you're not taking care of yourself, it's going to be really hard to pick up all the things with your athletes that you're working with, because they have all this various stuff that's going on. And they're not just telling us everything that's going on, right? So you're having to be very savvy about picking up some things with what's going on with your team or particular athletes. But if you can start with focusing on yourself, I think that's a good thing. So self-care is just a practice of taking an active role in protecting your well-being. It's focusing on controlling the controllables, which is what we're going to talk about in a second, and integrating some mind-body medicine techniques to reduce stress. So focusing on the controllables, we want to make sure proper sleep. You guys had a sleep expert come in, I think. Did anybody change their sleep patterns or their philosophy about sleep after you had that person come in? Are you sleeping fairly well? Nobody's willing to admit that they're not? Great. 8 hours, 7 hours? Who's getting 7 hours at least? Okay, good. So restorative exercise is tolerated. So sometimes I think we beat ourselves to the ground with exercise, right? I couldn't have heard this word restorative exercise, 10 years ago. But in terms of understanding what we have to do to be able to recover, that's the key thing. Connecting with others is really important. Sharing things with other people, maybe even talking in this room to one another would be really great. And then eliminating toxins. I obviously, in my little animation, I gave you a clue with the vampire thing. But toxins, and that includes energy vampires. If you know what those kind of people that are just pretty negative and not very fun to be around, so trying to eliminate those people if you possibly can. And then integrating recovery activities. So mind-body medicine is using natural connections between mind and body to improve physical functioning, reduce stress, and promote health. So again, that starts with the breath. The whole thing around like meditation, mindfulness, it's been around for 2,000 years. It's not religious oriented. It might feel spiritual, but it has nothing to do. It originally came from a Buddhist background, but it certainly is this meditation, mindfulness, just being able to be centered. It's among the most widely used integrative medicine practice among U.S. adults. So these are the type of techniques, and I think you're having somebody talk about yoga a little bit later on this morning. But these are all the things that we can do in order to be able to connect with ourselves and be able to calm ourselves down and just be able to be clearer. And it's not to be overly relaxed, but it's really being able to be more centered, to be able to manage things a little bit better and have some space between you and what's going on. So again, biofeedback, guided imagery. Do any of you do some guided imagery or think like relaxation exercises with your athletes at all with consistency? So sometimes now I hear athletes, not just yours, but lots of other ones come in and say like, oh yeah, my coach does that like right before a big something or other, right? So, but doing it with consistency, most of them love it. And not just to give an opportunity to take a little nap, but really to be able to practice some of those things. And I'm happy to provide some of those, but there's so much stuff out now on the internet, it's incredible. Tai Chi, something you can do. Again, group support, talking to each other, talking to coaches, other coaches outside of here. Pranayama, breath, it sounds very fancy. It's really that diaphragmatic breathing thing that I've taught all of you before. Diaphragmatic with it, just deep in your belly all the way up through your chest, and then mindfulness. So the mindfulness piece is really about trying to stay in the present moment on purpose, kind of paying attention on purpose as non-reactively, non-judgmentally, and kind of open-heartedly as possible. Do any of you practice meditation on a regular basis at all? Anybody? Nobody. Okay. All right. So those are some of the things you can do. There's a lot of apps out there now that can help you guide you through that if it's something of interest for you. So I'm going to do a little exercise with you here in a second, but some mindfulness awareness of routine activities that you can have. So it's bringing practice, bringing your mindful attention to daily activities that are often performed mindlessly, paying attention to the movement of the body, sounds and sights of things around us. So these are some things you can do, like how often do you pay attention to just when you're brushing your teeth, right? So sometimes, and I pay attention to sometimes how much I walk around instead of just, I'm trying to do something while I'm brushing my teeth. But some of those kind of things are really interesting. While you're taking a shower, just really paying attention to what you're doing. You can even have a meditation practice with drinking coffee. So lots of stuff there. just to be able to pull yourself into what you're doing, maybe even just while you're driving. I am guilty of this, like just doing multiple things while we're driving, and we're driving, you know, 70 miles an hour or 65, I guess, and we're talking on the phone or paying attention to something else while we're driving this large vehicle. So walking in between meetings, kind of at bedtime, to be able to practice some of that stuff. So truthfully, this is some of the stuff, again, I teach your athletes. It's I've kind of come to know that this whole breathing and this meditation stuff or the mindfulness stuff is really about being able to control some of your thoughts, get out of the monkey mind kind of stuff, as we call it, meditation. So if you're feeling a little catastrophic in your thinking sometimes or a little chaotic, being able to bring yourself back and creating space is a really helpful thing. So what studies are showing in terms of the mindfulness piece, I mean, there's so much in the literature now. So if this is of interest to you at all, improving your sleep, creating resiliency, again, this is what I teach your athletes, helping you deal with fear, improving confidence, concentration, lots and lots of stuff. That reducing sympathetic arousal, that last one is really around that autonomic nervous system. And then with mindfulness practice, practicing kindness towards yourself. And that might sound too kumbaya to you, but in general, high performers are really hard on themselves and they beat themselves up. We have thousands and thousands of thoughts on our head all day. So paying attention to what kind of thoughts you're having, if you're being kind to yourself or not, but kind of pulling it back to being able to be a little kinder. Creating but not settling on a new normal. If you're kind of dealing, I teach that with athletes, like if they've had some sort of injury, what can they, how can they find some purpose, especially while they're injured? Finding a new sense of purpose, finding an opportunity for optimism and gratitude, being thankful. They get a lot, you know, they're kind of privileged here for sure. And we're all kind of privileged to be able to be in this kind of space, even talking about this stuff today. And course correction for an effective mindset. So the course correction bit is really about, again, bringing your thoughts back to what you're trying to do versus when you're beating yourself up or thinking about not being able to accomplish something and being hard on yourself. So I wanted to do a little bit of a mindfulness thing, a little breath thing, if that's okay with all of you. Promise to stay awake. Sorry for you in the back if they don't, right, or next. So just if you would, just pay attention to your body language right now, and maybe just sit up in more of a, like a dignified sort of, give your lungs a place to breathe. Kind of a dignified manner. That's very dignified over there, volleyball guys. Yeah. Okay. So if you're comfortable closing your eyes, it'd be great. Nobody's going to be looking at you, I promise. And just, again, settle into this comfortable position. And you can allow your eyes to just have a softened gaze downward if you don't feel comfortable closing your eyes. And just begin by taking several long, slow, deep breaths. Breathing in fully and exhaling fully. And breathe in through your nose and out your nose or your mouth. And allow your breath to find its own natural rhythm, not trying to change it in any way, but just allow yourself to breathe. And bring your full attention to noticing each in-breath as it enters your nostrils, travels down through your lungs, and causes your belly to expand. And notice each out-breath as your belly contracts and air moves up through the lungs, back up through the nostrils of your mouth, and invite your full attention to flow with your breath. Notice how the inhale is different from the exhale. You may experience the cool air as it enters your nose and warm as you exhale. As you turn more deeply inward, begin to let go of any noises around you. And if you're distracted by sounds in the room, simply notice them and bring your intention back to your breath. Simply breathe as you breathe, not striving to change anything about your breath. And don't try to control your breath in any way, just observe and accept your experience in this moment without judging, paying attention to each inhale and exhale. And if your mind wanders to thoughts, plans, or problems, simply notice your mind wandering. Watch the thought as it enters your awareness as neutrally as possible. Then practice letting go of the thought as if it were a leaf floating down a stream. And in your mind, place each thought that arises on a leaf and watch it as it floats out of sight down the stream. Then bring your attention back to your breath. Your breath is an anchor you can return to over and over again when you become distracted by thoughts. Notice again when your mind has wandered. Observe the types of thoughts that hook or distract you. Noticing is the richest part of learning. With this knowledge, you can strengthen your ability to detach from thoughts and mindfully focus your awareness back on the qualities of your breath. Practice coming home to the breath with your full attention, watching the gentle rise of your stomach on the in-breath and the relaxing letting go on the out-breath. Allow yourself to be completely with your breath as it flows in and out. You might become distracted by pain or discomfort in the body, or twitching or itching sensations that draw your attention away from the breath. You may also notice feelings arising, perhaps sadness or happiness, frustration or contentment. Acknowledge whatever comes up, including thoughts or stories about your experiences. Simply notice where your mind went without judging, pushing it away, clinging to it, or wishing it were different, and simply refocus your mind and guide your attention back to your breath. Breathe in and breathe out. Follow the air all the way in and all the way out. Mindfully be present moment by moment with your breath. If your mind wanders away from your breath, just notice without judging it, be it a thought, emotion, or sensation that hooks your attention, and gently guide your awareness back to your breathing. As this is coming to an end, just slowly allow your attention to expand and notice your entire body. Do a quick body scan as you exhale. Allow it to go from head to toe, relaxing any muscles that feel tense. And then allow your attention to go beyond your body to the room you're in. And then when you're ready, you can open your eyes and come back fully alert and awake. And allow this to help you feel more confident and strong. Everyone awake? What's that like? Who felt impatient? Anybody feel impatient with it? No? What was it like? Neutral, good, horrible, it's okay? Okay, all right. Does everyone feel pretty good? So that's mindfulness stuff. Allowing to just keep coming back to that stuff, yeah. It's good. So any questions, any thoughts? Anything that you want to ask in terms of stuff that I do with your athletes? Yeah.
So it came to a few people's attention this year that some coaches for student athletes didn't know that they had access to you. So how can us, as one of sports medicine staff, coaching staffs, kind of promote you and what you can do for our student athletes?
So maybe we can talk about a little bit more to the coaches and to the athletes. I think the freshmen that Susan had as a seminar this year, I was introduced to all of them, which was great. Are these older kids?
So we found on the committee I'm on just a lot of exit interviews with seniors, and this is probably not so much this year's seniors, but probably the past 2 years of them saying that they didn't even know that they had access to a sports.
Okay. Yeah, and I think, Dave, I mean, you can speak to that too. I think we've kept it not completely under wraps by any means, but I think because we want to try and go through O'Connor Sports Center at first, right? I think that's the not O'Connor, what is it?
McGrath,
excuse me. Yeah, so go to McGrath first. So I'm a clinical sports psychologist with Xavier. I'm totally seeing people just on a performance enhancement and not any clinical work, so I think we were trying to do that through McGrath first, so it probably gets a little confusing too. So we can maybe figure out for next year how we want to announce that a little bit more without it going people going crazy over it, right? Yeah. Any other questions, any thoughts? Yes. Yeah, so, and I think it's really hard for people to do some of these things, so I even say start with 5 or start with a minute if you want to. This one great app that it's called Insight Timer, it's free, and just a plethora of like meditation or mindfulness exercises on it. So they even have like a 5-minute free thing on each one of their things, and if you want to pay premium, you have to for more time. But I think starting with just a couple of minutes, and I think doing it, I suggest nowadays for people to bookend their days with it. So if you can start your day with some of that kind of stuff. I have a lot of people that I work with that wake up a little anxious, but just trying to do that for 5 minutes in the morning, just kind of set an intention for the day and what do you want your energy to be like. And then at the end of the day, just to kind of calm thoughts down. That's what I find for most people. It's really hard to be able to shut that down. I don't know if any of you guys have that, but just being busy. And I might not look like it, but I'm 100% wired as a type A person. I'm completely type A. So I think just trying to rewire yourself a little bit to recognize what you can use from some of this, kind of calming down to clear the head. And it's not, again, to be kumbaya all the time. It's not to slow you down so that you're not getting work done, but I'm thinking about it more as recovery. So I think the energy expenditure when you're on can be exactly the same, but it's really trying to create some of these recovery activities and almost be preventive in the morning, but definitely at nighttime. You'll get more sleep if you can kind of, number one, do the things that I'm sure the sleep expert talked about with just shutting stuff down an hour beforehand anyway, why we think we can just be crazy, busy and then go to sleep. It's impossible, right? But the idea of being able to kind of titrate yourself down to being able to be relaxed, it's a great thing to do is listen into some guided imagery or some mindfulness kind of stuff with the breathing, kind of combining it with that, and be able to, again, 5 minutes just to start so it doesn't feel overwhelming. A lot of mindfulness practices, people talk about doing 20 minutes, there's people do longer, but I think just starting with 5 is great, just being aware of it. And then the other thing is great is not just using it for that. It's sort of we say we should exercise and then people sit for 8 hours after they exercise for an hour. And that's like smoking, like a pack of smoking cigarettes is what they keep talking about is the equivalent of it if you're just sitting all day is the same thing to your heart. Maybe Rick, you can talk about that if that's true or not. But I think trying to put some of this stuff during the day, again, 30 seconds worth if you're about to go into a meeting, right? Or if you're kind of going from one thing to the next instead of being on your phone, just being really aware of how you're reacting to things or how you can respond in a different way. Again, because stress kind of, I like to think about a bubble being around us, we're kind of maintaining composure and letting stuff bounce off of us, but sometimes that bubble gets burst and you kind of feel all that stress in your being. You might react to somebody because of lots of stressors that you didn't mean to react in that way or act in a particular way that you just are not really happy with, you know. So trying to integrate some of this stuff during the day is a great thing to do. Yeah. No, I don't think it's a failure. I think it's probably an indication that you're really super tired if you're falling asleep, right? So maybe taking a nap is a great way to be mindful, right, about your body. So that's why a lot of them, I mean, again, you can sit in any possible way you want. You don't have to be, you know, cross-legged with your hands like this. So I think that's where they talk about like kind of the dignified posture, because at least you're kind of keeping yourself awake and aware. But I do plenty of mine, like just lying down, and the best relaxing pose we can possibly be in, if any of you do yoga, is Shavasana, which is like, it's the equivalent of corpse pose, which is, yeah, just like no appendages touching, you know, lying down flat. And you can do some mindfulness stuff with that. Sometimes you might fall asleep, sometimes you might not, and it's okay, yeah. And that would be a great thing to happen if you were doing that at nighttime, right? It would help you fall asleep even more quickly. Yeah, it's good. Anybody else? Excellent. Have a great rest of the year. I guess the school year is over, correct? I saw all these people moving out. Yay, good. You made it. One more year, right? Good. So and at any point in time, if you guys need to get in touch with me, please just do. You know, I hope that you have my email or my phone number. Some of you already do contact me with some frequency. So I appreciate it, and I love working with all of you and all your athletes. And I'm sorry we never reconnected, which is really sad, so we'll have to talk maybe after this, but we'll figure it out, okay? All right, great. Have a good rest of the day. Thank you.
That we the drive, is it reading? It's all right, it's not critical. All right, good morning. I know now that you've just been relaxed and everyone has shut their eyes for a while, best thing you want to talk about is campus safety and security, right? Now, I know I haven't had a chance to meet many of you. My prior experience, I was a trial attorney when I first started out professionally, worked for a few years here in Cincinnati, then went to the FBI. And I was a special agent with them for a little over 21 and a half years. Not completely separated from federal service, then was looking for a way to land back here in Cincinnati and also continue in higher education. I have three sons that are, one's a junior in high school, one's a freshman in high school, and then I've got an 11-year-old as well. So I thought, well, that's great. I'd find some spot in higher education. That might be where they want to transition. Where does the oldest want to go? The Ohio State University. The freshman's already considering a DAP program at University of Cincinnati. So as long as we keep that state or that school concept going, that's great. Otherwise, I've told my 11-year-old, let's go X. That's the way he's going to go. We'll visit the school from the north, south, east, or west side, however he'd like to come and stop by. But as far as student athletes, my experience has been kind of interesting. I started in my undergrad. I was a resident in residence life. I worked as a resident assistant, also worked as a hall director. And I can just say, and I was talking in the back of the room, how glad I am we don't have a football program. Just from some of the issues, some of the other problems and things that I've seen in other institutions that are generated from that, I look at the programs that you have here And I think there's not only a high expectation of performance, but there's also a high expectation for the character that your athletes bring to the campus and their performance. And my role and how I see that interacting with the campus as a whole, as well as with the students and the faculty staff here, is to provide a safe environment for that to happen. Now, some of the initiatives that we have here, certainly it's awareness. It's one of the reasons that I'm out here speaking with you today. We do have a safety committee that engages the faculty, staff, and students as far as different programs and what are going to be brought forward. One of the topics this summer that we're going to be pushing is some active shooter awareness and training. And you can tell in the news that that is something that is at the forefront. I think a lot of people have questions as far as their preparedness and what would happen, what would they do. And my role is to be sure that you have those tools, and that is something much like the mantras or the thought process and the mindfulness that you were talking about just before this. It's something that is ingrained. You know where to go, you know what to do, you are prepared in the event that there's an emergency. And community-oriented policing. I think who all has been on Xavier's campus for more than 1 year? You probably have had some sort of interaction or seen the officers out and about, engaged in different programs, providing security at events, or providing a special detail. Particularly, that's where we have engaged in our role with athletics. But ultimately, it's everyone's responsibility. We can't be everywhere. You are the eyes and the ears of the campus and of our community. So if you see something, if you notice something that's out of place, you're in the facilities, you're in the locations, you're in the venues, you know what is familiar, who is supposed to be there and who isn't. Contact us. Let us know so that we can more effectively do our role and help you perform yours as well. So be the eyes and the ears for us if you see it, hear it, or report it. And the two numbers I think that most folks do know, the 745-2000 is our dispatch. That's the non-emergency number, the 745-1000. And of course, if there's a health emergency, it's still 911. We do have the safety sites, kind of a central locating point on our hub that we can get out information and updates. Also, our police department has a number of different quick facts. One thing a lot of folks don't recognize, yes, we are real police. This is a full police department, sworn officers, full arrest authority. We are carrying weapons, tasing devices, handcuffs, etc., and we do have concurrent jurisdiction. So with the city of Cincinnati, it is districts 2 and district 4, as well as Norwood. We share a lot of those boundaries as you go around our campus, and while our jurisdiction is essentially 1 square mile, we do back up these other departments from time to time, depending on what the situation may be. And there are a lot of things that happen in our community and our immediate neighborhoods, and it's a balance. I mean, certainly we are looking at a community-oriented policing and protecting our folks here and the campus community, staff, faculty, and students, but we also have to extend that, and we work very closely with the community in Evanston and in Norwood. Cleary, this is where you'll also have a lot of interaction, particularly with the Division I athletics. As you're traveling out or going on away games, we are sending out information, trying to figure out where you'll be staying, those locations. Part of our reporting under this act, it's a federal law, requires us to report any criminal activity at those locations or places where we will have the students spending time or spending an extended period, being over the 24-hour mark. So there's a lot of correspondence that goes on over at the police department with the schedules and with the folks that are going out. I know there's also a requirement or a policy that's in place when folks are traveling, giving contact information, emergency contact numbers, and so forth. So that is another role that's kind of on our radar when we're conducting our day-to-day operations. Also, fire safety, planning and training, also trying to advocate workplace safety, safe practices, just awareness, quite frankly. And as to tie into my colleague that spoke immediately before, that mindfulness and being aware not only of yourself, but also of your surroundings. Situational awareness goes a long way in getting through your day safely, and also, as I said, recognizing what doesn't fit in, where something is out of sorts. The safety team and safety communications, we're working right now, as I talked about, the active shooter program as one tool, but a number of others that the building coordinators and each of the structures across campus. When you add up the numbers and spaces, I know you spend probably a great deal of time in the athletics department. O'Connor, probably the new hub once it is up and running and fully functional, will be home bases for a lot of the folks. However, we're looking at that broad picture. So we have points of contacts that are there. If you are not familiar with who your building coordinator will be, this is also a program where we're starting to try to get education and information pushed out through them. And there's a list or a link down there for those individuals. We'll skip through some of that. Risk management and insurance that is also housed over there in our Flynn Hall. So a lot of the folks that are providing transportation, that are moving folks to and from point A to point B, we're being certain that they have that adequate coverage, they're well-trained in doing what they're supposed to be doing and providing those services. And then, of course, if something should happen, loss, accidents, etc., being sure that we have the adequate coverage to protect all of you and get you back to the place where you started if something does go wrong. Some of the other tips that are here on campus, everyone is familiar with XU Alert, Alert Me. That goes out first as a text message, can also go out as a phone message as well if it is something that is particularly urgent or important. If you are not registered for that or have not opted in, I think most folks that's an automatic, but we have a lot of camps that are gonna be going on during the course of the summer. So we're trying to provide this as a service to those folks that are coming on board as well. And you see our numbers down there at the bottom, non-emergency and emergency. So I know I had a grand total of, 10 to 15 minutes. I've blown through the first 10, but I will open it up right now if you have questions for me, since I am the new face here with the Xavier University Police, or if you've ever wanted to just ask a retired FBI guy and never had an opportunity to do so. You can go ahead and do that, too. So I'll open it up for 5 minutes if you have any questions. It's cooler than it is on TV, all right? Anyone? All right, well, really, I appreciate the opportunity to come out and at least put a face with a name this morning. I'm certain that we'll cross paths again at the different events and the different functions. You'll see me around with the officers. This is usually going to be my attire. I'm not necessarily going, that's what I'm comfortable in. I'm dressed down today. So I will not necessarily be in a uniform with the traditional policing perspective, but certainly we are here to be sure that you have a safe and secure environment in Xavier University and when you're doing your operations, as well as supporting the athletic programs here. So I appreciate the opportunity to come out and speak with you this morning. If I can ever do anything for all of you, please don't hesitate to call. And I'm right next door over here at Flynn Hall. At least for the next 5 years, I believe, I'm understanding this whole red building concept. Anyone else talked with physical plant on the development and the long range planning? No? I'll tell you, it's an interesting endeavor as well. But not a lot of modifications will be going on over at Flynn, so we'll be there for a little while. Thank you again. Appreciate the opportunity to come out.
All right, thank you for talking. I did this last year. We went like a real deep dive into our protocols. I think I know most faces here. And this year, I'm gonna do a little different. So we talk about concussions. Most people know you know, think about a direct kind of hit to the head, whether in any type of sporting event. We see a lot of our athletes who fall off, you know, Lime scooters or fall in their bathrooms. So athletes can have non-sports related concussions as well, car accidents, go-kart accidents, whatever the case may be. You also, instead of a direct blow to your head, you can also get hit in the chest. Think about like football players, hit there, there's that, you know, kind of whiplash kind of injury. Whatever the case, you can see the brain jiggles like jello inside the skull. So that's what we're trying to, you know, that's what happens. And when we take a look at people with concussion, this is kind of our overall way we kind of manage them based on their injuries. So it starts not at the time of injury, but long before that. So in the purple boxes, when we do our pre-participation exams, we ask them how many concussions they've had. We've asked them, you know, oh, if you had two, how long did this one take? So we kind of get an idea of knowing how long, you know, what their kind of history is. We're looking at other risk factors that we know can prolong recovery. So if they have underlying mental health issues, depression, anxiety, a lot of those overlap with our the questions we ask about concussion. So those people can have a little bit longer recoveries. ADHD those patients can have longer recoveries as well. So we start there. And one of the things we like to know is, you know, as you get more and more concussions, the potential for them to have prolonged recoveries is possible. Mechanisms injury, obviously our athletic trainers are there. Coaches are helpful if we can get, if there's an incident, we can get video to kind of look at the mechanism of injury to try to see what happened. A lot of times it's pretty obvious, but sometimes we have to sift through some stuff, especially if someone takes a series of kind of small hits over the course of a game or two games, we can kind of try to identify those. So we have some ways that we can test their cognition or their brain function. So we use, currently we use the impact test, that's that computer test. We do a baseline, and then we kind of can compare that. So we're comparing themselves to themselves when they're hurt rather than just everyone else. And then also while, like immediately after the injury, using the SCAT-5 assessment form that goes through cognition, that's like, repeat these words, what's the months of the year backwards? So we're trying to determine, you know, what they know and how slow they are. We have sway, that's our way to test for postural or balance control. It's a computer, you use an iPad and you hold it there, and it's using the gyroscope inside the phone to determine how much movement they have. Some people are really affected by this, others aren't. Like all concussions are different. We have vestibular or vision tests as well. This has really exploded over the course of the past few years. We're doing this on all of our concussion patients, kind of from their first time. If someone has multiple concussions, I will do this at their physical, their pre-participation physical, so I know if there's any abnormalities. And we have physical therapists that specialize in this. One's over at Good Sam. There's another one we've started utilizing that's in Blue Ash that do training to kind of make these symptoms go away, these vision symptoms. So we all know the signs and symptoms of concussion. There's little groupings of them. And what we do is these are asked at baseline. So some of these, you know, especially in the pink category, someone may have those at baseline. So we're trying to identify what's their normal. And so we ask them at during when they take that impact test, it's there. And then so we kind of know what's normal. And then when they have concussions, we're serially following them. So every day, either it's checking in person or we're getting in touch with them to ask those questions to kind of track their symptoms. So those are the way we handle kind of our kind of concussion evaluation. What I want to spend the most time right now is talking about the knowledge, attitudes, and behaviors associated with concussion, because I think that's where we can gain most of our ground there. So athletes with prior concussions, so your chances are 3 to 6 times greater of having a second concussion if you already had one. And most of those in the studies happen within that first 7 days, which is not good. The brain does not respond well to a second injury while it's still trying to heal. It just sets it off, that whole cascade once again. Athletes with multiple concussions more likely to develop longer lasting symptoms. So instead of being ready to go in that 7 to 10 day, it's probably closer to 10 day mark. It can last weeks, months. I've had people who have had to medically retire because of concussions, and so that threatens their eligibility. And so we gotta be careful with getting people in that have 4 or 5 concussions already, because it makes us a little leery. All right, some questions. Get your audience participation. An athlete can continue to play after suffering a concussion without hurting their performance. True or false? I hope they all get this one right. So, false. Playing through it can lead to difficulty with attention span, concentration, and memory. So they may not remember the play. They may not remember how to line up correctly. So we're relying on, if we don't see something obvious, we're relying on our coaches to say, you know, I called this play or I told them to do this and they don't do it right. We need to know that. That's super important. Impediment to judgment and impulse control. So now you're playing more reckless. You're playing differently than you'd like them to play. Reductions in reaction time. That could be pretty obvious. It can be subtle. It can be the difference between letting someone go by you or, you know, being able to make a play on someone. And then challenges related to movement and balance. So if you're not at peak, you're not going to be able to perform. So think about how this can affect an athlete or the team's overall performance, something to kind of take home with you. Concussed athletes who continue to play with symptoms recover just as quickly as concussed athletes who report symptoms right away and are removed. So we have someone, we see it, we take them out, and as opposed to they continue, they don't tell us, we don't notice, and then we find out later. So again, that one's false. So if they did a study just a couple years ago, they took a college study, multiple sports, 5 days longer to get back to the into the return to play protocol for those people who weren't recognized right away. So if they continue to play through their symptoms, they took 5 days longer, and they were like twice as longer to have a recovery that lasted more than 8 days. So we want to know early. We can get them out. We can start their recovery, and they usually can get back quicker as opposed to trying to kind of hide it and get back in. When athletes return to play, they're at increased risk of leg injuries. True or false on this one? This one's an important one that we often overlook. So this one's actually true. 3 different studies, the risk could be 2 to 3 times more likely to have a lower leg injury during their concussion like recovery. Somewhere in that first 90 days, this bottom study just was out of Ohio State. They looked at their linemen who had concussions, and they saw the injury could it go into the next season, so up to 12 months longer. And these were ankle injuries, ACL injuries, so these were non-contact type injuries. So important with that as well. Concussions can sometimes lead to an athlete to have emotional problems. Definitely true. On probably a couple different fronts. So one is that some of the symptoms are irritability, emotionalness, sadness, depression. But these can happen because they're sad because they got hurt. They are away from their sport. That's sometimes their only identity, and they don't know how to be away from that sport, away from their teammates. And then now they're behind in class, and that just kind of that gets that whole ball rolling. And so that is something that we're pretty cognizant of when we do that. And so trying to incorporate them back into team activities when we think it's not going to make them worse as far as like the mental part of it, as far as like not exertional, but being able to go to meetings and things like that. athletes seldom experience pressure from a teammate, coach, parents, fans to continue playing after a head impact. So there's a study and there's a whole separate webpage. So 1 in 4 of this college athletes said that they got pressure, and it's probably higher than that, but got pressure to not report. The groups who, so there's a couple reasons they don't report symptoms. So the first 5 are the athletes' kind of impression. So they didn't think they had it. They didn't think it was serious enough. They didn't think there was negative consequences to it, that they thought they could try to play through it and then just say it afterwards, or they didn't want to be removed. So these are the top 10 reasons they don't report. So the first 5 are on them, so we educate them. The next 5, that's why we're here talking to you guys. So they didn't want to disappoint coaches, teammates, parents, and fans by coming out of the game. They felt pressure when they came out of the game. They believed that they were expected to play injured. They feared the negative consequences of reporting, so loss of playing time, loss of their starting position, having their toughness questioned. And then they thought that, you know, even though they wanted to report, but if it wasn't shared, that same philosophy wasn't shared with the coaching staff, they thought they would then, they didn't want to have social disapproval. So if we look at the typical recovery, you have a concussion and it gets better. And then we can let them play and go on. If we try to push them too hard, that recovery can just take a little longer. So we have to balance trying to get them active, whether it's in school, doing their classwork, starting some physical activity. And we're pushing that physical activity earlier and earlier to try to see if we can get them better kind of quicker. If they have a repeat injury before they're better, then it kind of just sets the whole cascade off. And what we don't want, those are still getting better. Those lines are coming, you know, slowly down to baseline. What we don't want is them to develop this course where they just continue to get worse despite our best efforts. And so this is kind of our overall thing, and this is the last slide that I have. Questions about our concussion policy, protocols, anything that you have?
How can people fail the impact test?
So Impact has a computer program that runs behind it to look at how they've done in comparison to, let's say they're 19 years old. So they look at all the other 19-year-olds and they're like little built-in metrics to kind of compare them to the other people and how well they did on the test. Who's taken an impact test in here? Like physically gone through the process. It's not a good, it's terrible. Sometimes a mouse doesn't work, you know, so there's a lot of different things, but it's the best thing we have to try to objectify subjective things. There's no other test for me to know other than if they get hit in the head and they stumble around, then we know. But like, you know, there's no other way. Sometimes it's pretty subtle. So it's looking at this computer program and it gives us an idea of if they're, it's kind of like a good test taker, bad test taker, essentially. And there's a number that they use that we think. So they're only failing it. It just may not be as accurate when they take it again to say, that's part of the test. They've done studies that like people who don't have concussions take the test and then they get lower scores. So it's like, is that because they didn't sleep the night before? So these are people without concussions who take it at the same time like they have other people who do have concussions, and they're finding variability. So that's why we look at those numbers, and it's not like you have to get exactly back to the same number you had before. There's a range. But that just makes it less usable, but we still use it. So we have them take it. If they can't get it, we do it again. Sometimes they make, if it's getting closer, we'll like, hey, come when you are like fresh in the morning, don't come right after 3 hours of class, try not to take it, you know, what did you do the night before? Hopefully you got sleep, you didn't do things you're not supposed to do. I think that all helps set them up for a better test. So we weren't really, like, they started not to look at these, and so if it's bad and then you do good and then it looks like you're great, but you're still probably symptomatic, you know. So, but that's a good question. We're having less and less, but there's always a few now. Everyone knows our, you know, return to play protocols, and we try to, our new thing, we just came back from our conference, and some of that postural control that we talked about, we may do some kind of rehab as far as sports performance kind of rehab to maybe get them a little bit better following, to kind of maybe save off some of those leg injuries and other injuries. But, you know, that's a work in progress. And then we're going to look a little bit more closely at a little bit of physical activity. You know, if they're at the 5-6 day mark, still have symptoms, maybe not quite ready to get back into like full thing, but maybe to do a little bit of light, what they call, if you've kind of read the literature or looked through it, it's a sub-symptom threshold. So if they can like walk to class and it doesn't hurt, well, maybe we'll get them in and do a little bit more like intense walking while they're still symptomatic to try to see if we can get them feeling better. So we may be able to have them do things rather than just sit around and do nothing. So our goal is. So this active treatment, but it really all comes down to kind of symptoms and how they perform on balance, the cognitive tests and their VOMS and vision testing. To go to the vision testing so that the VOMS or the balance stuff, they usually have to have symptoms more than a week, otherwise the therapists don't want to see them. Most of them get better. That vestibular stuff gets better in that 5 to 6 to 7 day range. So if it's more than a week and they still can't track or they're having problems taking notes from the board to their, from, you know, workstation to board back and forth, then we'll send them and they do better. So, other questions, concerns? We have to follow the policy. It's part of the NCAA mandate. There are schools that you can actually get a, I don't know what the enforcement of it is. That's a Jeff question. But there are people who have gotten penalties or sanctions for not following their concussion protocol. And we opted in, as the Big East and Xavier opted in to the to following the policies. We have to send it in every year and stuff. So that's why we're talking. All right, well, let me know. You can always find me after, have one of the athletic trainers get in touch with me as well. So, all right, thanks.
Am I good? Okay, cool. Okay. Okay.
Very important.
All right. Yeah, so for those of you who don't know who I am, I'm Coach Aaron French. This is...
I'm Dan Ridenour.
Yeah, so we're here obviously filling in for the staff. Just want to go over some things that... just some policies and procedures, philosophy, mission statement, I know most of you guys are familiar with the strength and conditioning department and what we do, hopefully we can bring some clarity to that if you guys have any questions. First of all, if you guys don't know, the Xavier Strength Department has a relationship with Ignition APG. It's a private performance training facility located in Cincinnati. So myself, Dan, Coach Rod, and Coach Jake are all contracted out to Xavier. So we assist Coach Jennings, which is it's a really, really good partnership. It allows Coach Jennings to get that help to cover all the teams. So for those of you who don't know, if you haven't seen, or if you've seen Ignition apparel that we're wearing, that's who we're with. And that relationship, I think, has been going on for about 2 years now. And so I think it's been really positive for both sides. And we're really fortunate to be down here and to get the experience at the collegiate level and to serve your team. So myself, I serve women's golf, men's golf, and men's and women's cross country. And then Coach Dan serves men's and women's track. And then Coach Jake serves soccer, women's soccer, women's basketball, volleyball, and baseball. And then Coach Rod serves men's and women's swimming and men's soccer. So all those sports are split up. Obviously, Coach Jennings serves basketball. We're also able to help him out with that. So really, really cool opportunity to have that. Another thing we wanted to address, we were fortunate enough to have a few championship teams this year. Men's swimming, want to congratulate you guys for your season and what you guys accomplished. Women's golf, very historic season and accomplishing a championship. And then we had a men's golf individual champion. So we're really excited to see that. Our purpose in the weight room, obviously, is just to serve your athletes and you guys and to help you guys achieve your goals and your aspirations. So we're just fortunate to be able to share in that success. So we'll go over just a few things on our mission statement, philosophy, and then rules and procedures, and then what we hope to accomplish this summer, and then heading into the next school year. So Dan, do you want to go over some of the mission statement real quick? And then we'll cover some of the other things.
So I believe this is on the website, right?
Yeah.
But I mean, at the core of it, like Aaron just said, we're here to help you guys help the athletes, right? I mean, we're here, we all have the same goal, and that's win and keep kids healthy, mainly, right? So verbatim, the strength conditioning staff at Xavier University is dedicated and committed to excellence as teachers and coaches of the sport and science behind the art of strength conditioning. All strength conditioning modalities and protocols are fully supported by current scientific peer-reviewed research and are executed through prudent, productive, practical, and purposeful training applications. Furthermore, the Xavier University strength conditioning staff will adamantly maintain compliance with all policies and procedures set forth by the NCAA, the Big East, and Xavier. So basically, we're always trying to adapt things. We're always trying to build and move things forward in accordance with best practice, and part of that is coordinating with athletic medicine, coordinating with any sort of medical side of it, coordinating with any sort of nutrition interventions that we have, and then coordinating with you guys, the coaches. So, the main goal is try to just collaborate as much as we can and help move things forward so everyone's on the same page, because that's how kids slip through the cracks if we aren't. So.
Yeah, and our ultimate goal, obviously, is the health and well-being of the student athlete. So, that's what we're trying to do when we program. Obviously, our communication with sports medicine, the ultimate goal is to keep athletes healthy so they can compete, and then obviously help their performance in the weight room. So if you guys don't know, obviously some of the rules and procedures, I know that you guys, I know Coach Jennings has talked about that, but some of the rules and procedures in the weight room, no athletes are on their cell phones or anything like that. That's just for safety, and that includes, I think, coaches as well on that. So. We obviously try to keep the weight room presentable, and that's something that we communicate to our athletes as well. So just to kind of create a positive discipline culture in the weight room, and hopefully we can continue to communicate that to the coaches as well. So like Dan said, we're all on the same page. We just all want to make sure that from our standpoint in the strength room, that we're doing our best to communicate with you guys, that we can take your input and serve you guys the best we can. See here, I think administrative topics that we wanted to go over. I think some of the coaches have received an end of the year survey. Did anyone not receive that? Okay, no interest. So that's something we want to be able to get out to our athletes to make sure that we can get feedback from them on how we can better serve you guys and the athletes. One of the things that we're working on too is the fuel station. We're doing some work to get better options. Better fuel options for athletes. So that's in the works right now. And then summer training, one of the things we're working on now is getting summer programs out to our athletes. And if we need to communicate with you guys to help encourage kids, especially that won't be here, to partake in summer training so that they're ready to go come August. So we'll be sending those programs out if we haven't already. But we hope that you guys can help us encourage your athletes to stay disciplined and stay focused throughout the summer. I know they have different responsibilities, but we want to make sure they're ready to come back come August if they haven't taken the whole summer off. So let's see here. Oh, one of the things, too, I think that we wanted to hit on is we have developed or begin developing a relationship with the sports science department. Obviously, I don't know if you guys know, but the sports science department here is relatively new. And I know a few of the teams we've done FMS, the FMS screening with some of your teams. So we're just trying to work with the sports science department to gather data. If you've wondered why we've done FMS with some of your teams, that's why, is to try to create a database to give our students better feedback in terms of their movement screening and how we can help them. So that's an ongoing relationship. It's kind of fluid right now, but we feel like we've developed a good start to that. And I know some of the coaches were still kind of introducing that to you, to your teams, and kind of getting your teams introduced to that. So that's an ongoing collaboration that we hope to continue to develop. We've worked with both professors of the sports science department with that. So that's kind of a new thing this year. I think that's pretty much, Coach Jennings also said that he will follow up with you guys in terms of end of the year evaluations. So if you guys have any questions with that, obviously you can refer those to him, but he definitely wants to stay in communication with every head coach to make sure that we're getting the proper feedback so that we can do our jobs better. We just want to make sure that we're growing and continuing to serve you guys better. So please let us know what we can do better to better serve you, your teammate, your teams, and just make sure that we're at the end of the day ultimately serving and providing the best environment for our student athletes here. So that's it for me. Any questions? At all? No? Okay. Cool. All right. Thank you.
Appreciate it. So again, we're not wasting too much of your Friday morning here. So we're going to speak, and then Dr. Dixon has a career day with her daughter until 10 o'clock. So we're going to see if maybe Scott can go through the CPR refresher, and then Dr. Dixon can end our day with her talk. So we're just going to go through kind of, there's only a few updates with us, but also just kind of open it up for you guys to ask us questions or give us feedback on what's going on with our department and all that. To piggyback off of what Aaron and Dan were talking about with the strength department, we now have a sports performance group that involves sports medicine, TriHealth, Beacon, strength conditioning, the exercise science program on campus. So if there's any things that you guys see as coaches that we're lacking in, please bring that to the attention of either us as the sports medicine staff or the strength conditioning staff, and then we can bring it to those meetings. And we're having those, I think, once a month. And I think Ed is gonna join us starting next year. So we'll have a voice for you guys at those meetings. So unbeknownst to him, apparently. So. But just real quick, going to go through our EAPs. We just got back from our Big East Conference, and we were stressed about sharing these with you guys, so we want to go over those. Weather, I'll touch on. I know it's everybody's favorite. We are changing, though. And then just kind of some general rules about the athletic training facility downstairs. So obviously, I'm Connor. I've been here almost 5 years now. I work with the women's basketball team. Dave Fluker, our head athletic trainer. Bree Cugliari in the back. Jim Seeger in the back as well. So Jim is new. He kind of filled in a PRN position for us this year, and he's also a registered dietitian, so he is doing some nutrition cases as well. So he's a really good resource to have. And then, unfortunately, Nate is on the road with baseball. JJ is on the road with track at Big East, and Connor is off gallivanting in Australia. So, okay, so just emergency action plans. Why do we have these in place? Obviously, it's just for the safety of everybody involved. It's the safety of you guys as coaches, our student athletes, ourselves, the spectators, and then the university from litigation as well. So if an athletic trainer is present, if a doctor is present, we kind of run the show with these emergency action plans. We would just need you guys to assist in any way, whether that's making phone calls or standing out and giving directions or just kind of handling the team or the crowd if it is at a game. Protects from litigation for the university if we all follow the same rule and do the same thing if we're on the same page. Us as athletic trainers meet with the visiting team athletic trainer and go over everything. It's what we call medical timeout and kind of go over what the rules are and where the paramedics are. We do have paramedics at almost all of our home events, both basketballs, volleyball, baseball, both soccers, always have EMS on site. So.
Yes. Lead the way, and you guys just kind of, you know, help as much as you can, because if we try to depend on the students, it's not. I think because we're adults, and I like for us to kind of lead the way on emergency type situations. But you know, if we're caught in a situation where we're depending on the students, I mean that's a different situation. But I think we need to lead the way on emergency type situations.
All right, so what is your guys' role in this? So if there's no athletic trainer on site, if this is something off campus or something that we don't cover directly, and you are on campus, then you would call 745-1000, which Chief Warfel just spoke about. You also have the blue emergency phones. If you don't have your cell phone or it's dead or something, you can always use the blue emergency phones around campus. That'll connect you right to the dispatcher. And again, I think Chief Warfel mentioned it, but kind of didn't talk in depth. If it is a medical emergency and you think this person needs to be transported right away, please call 911 first. Don't wait for Xavier Police to show up and then make a decision. We're all adults and we're mature and we know what is something that's emergent or not. Off campus, call 911. We ask that you guys, if something happens and you're off campus, call 911 first, get that activated, and then contact us and we'll come and assist in any way. But waiting 10 minutes for us to get where you guys are and then for us to call 911, we're missing key time that could be helpful. So control the scene. Obviously, if there's other student athletes around, just make sure that, you know, everybody's calm and we're doing the best that we can to handle the situation. If we are on site, so practices that we cover, game that we cover, your job is just kind of assist us in any way, like Dave said. If we need your help with calling 911, grabbing the AED, or if we're saying, hey, the paramedics are coming, can you please flag them down at the main gates of the soccer field, things like that, just be available to help us with that. In the rare case, we may need you to help spine board, splint, things like that. We will be the point person. We will direct you. We're not going to let you guys do anything that you're uncomfortable with. So, and then obviously try to stay as calm as possible. AED locations. So this is big. Typically with the sports that are outside, there's one on the sideline for basketball, volleyball. And here we use the one out by Max's office, or we can bring one from the training room. So first floor, Max's office. There's one outside the weight room. We added one in that locker room hallway two summers ago, I think. And then the third floor, which is the concourse of this building, the TriHealth First Aid Room has an AED in it. And then also outside the banquet rooms downstairs, and then there's one up, I think, at the end of this hallway. So, and then in Schmidt, we always have one in the athletic training room. We actually added another one, so we can have one out at baseball and one out at soccer at the same time. And then we also added one a couple years ago to the third floor. So that's big for you guys as coaches if something happens where the training room is locked instead of waiting for us to get there, if you guys just go up to the third floor and grab it there. So that actually came about a couple years ago when a former soccer coach asked me what happens if I have a heart attack and there's no AED available. So we added that one not too long ago. And then O'Connor always has one. So if for some reason you are in there or you're at the soccer field doing an individual or something, you can always run in there and grab it. And then XUPD also has AEDs with them. And they carry them in their squad cars. So if you would call 1000, just say you need a squad car that has an AED in it.
For Schmidt Fieldhouse, for the folks that are in Schmidt Fieldhouse, or if you're practicing in the Schmidt Fieldhouse gym, on that third floor, does everybody know where the bathrooms are on the third floor? Okay, so it's just as you go in that door, it's on the right hand side on the wall. And the thing is, you know, don't be intimidated by the AED. So pull it out, open it up, and it'll tell you exactly what to do. It'll tell you exactly what to do. Just follow the directions of the AED. They're very explicit. Yeah.
Scott will touch on a little bit of the differences in the AEDs. What we did as a staff is gave you guys as coaches access to all the ones that are automated. Some you have to power on or hit a button, a switch first. But with all the AEDs that you guys would have access to, as soon as you flip the lid, it turns on and it gives you explicit instructions of where the pads are supposed to go and what you're supposed to do. So again, Scott will touch on that when he gets here and kind of put you through a test and all that stuff. So, but like Dave said, don't be intimidated. They're pretty foolproof. And even if you do put the pads on wrong, it'll correct you or not shock. So. So just a campus map. This is somewhat important for you guys when you're giving tours. You never know if you're walking down Academic Mall where you guys usually aren't, you know, familiar with, and someone goes down, you know which buildings have it. So I'd familiarize yourself kind of with this map. There's Cintas, Schmidt down here, and then the blue phones, again, always use those if you don't have a cell phone available. So this portion, we're just going to talk about where we tell EMS to go. So if we say, hey, ambulance is coming, can you please track it down for us? So just kind of pay attention to where you are for the most part. This building is just back in the loading dock. Pretty self-sufficient, just know exactly where that is. I think everybody knows where that is. For Schmidt Fieldhouse, if you're in the gym upstairs, what you're going to tell them is go down Winding Way and then go down that driveway that takes you past the ROTC building and the armory. And there's a driveway that goes all the way down to those double doors right outside the gym. That's the best location as opposed to trying to get a gurney through the hallway and up the stairs in that tiny building. And I know we're a few years away from not being in there anymore, which will be somewhat helpful. So for soccer, obviously just through the big main gate. If we have a game, typically the paramedics sit at the small gate. And just to touch on that, for I think only men's basketball, we have an ambulance on site. There's a shortage of ambulances in the Hamilton County area. So men's basketball has one, but everybody else does not have one on site. We can start the EMS with them there, and especially with our team physicians who are there and the athletic trainers. But then they, from TriHealth Event Medicine, will activate the squad to come and be there. Obviously, that changes with Big East tournaments and things like that. Yes, Doc.
So the paramedics who are on site at for soccer have all the stuff that's in an ambulance.
Just no ambulance.
Except for the ambulance. So they can do anything else that we need them to do. Baseball, they can depend what supplies they bring. But for that, then the ones that are here at the
top, yeah.
Like for women's basketball, volleyball, they can do anything we need to do. Except they just don't have the thing. What we found is when we start, they come, you know, then it is no different in response time and transfer.
So yeah, so what Doc was saying, they have med bags, intubation bags, splint bags, AEDs. So again, full function, just no actual transport. So big gate at soccer, O'Connor just through the front door in the lobby. For baseball, they're not here, but that's okay. Sometimes it doesn't matter. Is through the center field gate. So there's a little driveway that runs past the gym here in O'Connor and then just open the center field gate and they'll come out that way. Tennis, we recommend just coming up Webster instead of trying to go through campus. It's a little bit quicker, so off of Victory Parkway and then just come up. And then the tennis courts are right there. And that's it for all the on-campus ones. We have some off-campus ones, Makatiwa, Eastern Hills. We're working on Walnut Hills and some other places. Withrow, just to work on some of the off-campus places as well. So if you guys go there and you would like an EAP, please ask us. We were happy to provide it to you. Also, they're available in the coaches folder on the R drive if you ever need to look at that. So if you have problems accessing that, just let us know and we'll make sure you can get into it. Touching on mental health, so we're changing things up a little bit. Doc and Bree may be able to talk a little bit more on this. So typically what we did in the past is we have mental health questionnaires that we would give the freshmen when they came here for physicals. What we're going to start doing is actually doing those for everybody. This kind of came out of the few Big East mental health summits that we've been to so far. The third one's coming up this June. We will be attending just trying to build off kind of the talks there. So I think some coaches are going to go as well. It's a really good it's short, it's about a day, but really good information coming out of that. So we have right now three questionnaires, the Beck anxiety score, the patient health questionnaire, and then the female athlete triad that looks at just body mass and gives us an idea of if maybe a disordered eating is prevalent or not. So all these are reviewed by us as the athletic training staff, and also Dr. O'Cragley looks at them. If we deem that they need to be referred to McGrath, then we send that information to Tim Barron, who is our point person at McGrath. We don't have somebody exclusively that sees student athletes, but he has agreed to take on kind of being our point person. Now, if we refer them up there, Dr. Barron may not be the one seeing them. They have a few counselors, but he has agreed to kind of be the point person for us. So. Kind of similar to what Chief was saying, if you see something, say something. If you feel like a student athlete doesn't look right or they're just acting not themselves, obviously bring it to the attention of us as the medical staff, or I'll show you guys how to fill out the student concern form on your employee portal. That will go directly to the Dean of Students and Angie Neflin, and we'll get into that a little bit. But know your resources. You guys can always contact people at McGrath, the XU Action and Care Team, which is Angie Neflin in the Dean of Students office. XUPD, if it is a crisis situation, you can call XUPD, they'll take care of it. Or if it's a crisis situation and you think that person needs to be seen immediately, you can call McGrath, and McGrath will notify that student's RA or somebody, and they will walk them up to McGrath to be seen. It's not optional, so. And then obviously, if you know of any sexual discrimination, sexual assault cases, Kate Lawson is our Title IX coordinator. I think that says 11, but it's our Title IX, not 11. I didn't type that though, so that was brief. she's your person for Title IX cases. And obviously, as you guys know from her talk, I don't want to go into too much depth because she just spoke with us not too long ago. If somebody says something to you, you're not allowed to hold that information. You have to tell them. You have to refer that to Kate Lawson. Now, you can tell the student athlete, hey, if you tell me something, I have to say it. If you would like to speak to someone confidential, I can give you those resources. But just remember, if someone does bring it to your attention, you have to report it. So who to call? This is just a breakdown. These are, I think, in every single bathroom in this building in Schmidt. They're on the mirrors, so if you do notice something, it gives you a really good list of who to call. So the Dean of Students, the Action and Care Team, kind of one in the same here. Title IX coordinator, Center for Diversity, the Bias Advisory and Response Team, so that deals with any sort of like racial things that go on campus. I know we get alerts from them in our emails every now and then. Campus police, obviously, so 1,000 for emergency, 2,000 for non-emergency. Counseling services up in McGrath, and then psych services, which is at the Sycamore House, which I think you would have to go through McGrath first to get to there. All right, so I know we talked about this a couple years ago. How many are familiar with XU Act or XU Exact? Anybody? Nobody? Kind of? Okay, so Angie Neflin's come and spoke a few times. This all came out of Virginia Tech, where 30 people had small clues that something bad was going to happen but didn't have a central reporting system to tell people. And then obviously the Virginia Tech massacre happened, so we had to think about how do we better this. So if you notice anything, you would fill out the student concern form, and it all goes directly to Angie Neflin and the Dean of Students, so you can start to kind of paint a picture, and if it's something that they think needs to be looked into, they will reach out to that student, mostly via email, and just check in, and then sometimes obviously if there is a threat, then obviously police or other services will be kind of employed. So, but this is on your employee hub. So when you go to xavier.edu, you click the employee hub. There is a link on the right side. It just says student concern form. All you need to do is click that and fill out the form. And I think I can pull up the form real quick. But that's anything. If somebody says something that you're uncomfortable with, that just seemed off, or they just seem off, or if another teammate comes up to you and says, hey, so-and-so said some things last night about, you know, maybe wanting to kill themselves, and you're uncomfortable with having that conversation with that student athlete, then you can just fill out the student concern form and things will kind of go from there. So.
Yeah, I think it's so important to reply to something like this. Just recently with the shooting, high school shooting in Colorado, they interviewed a kid, and the kid was saying that the two shooters
So this is kind of what this form looks like. It's just got a bunch of drop-down menus. Obviously, you fill out your information, and then you kind of get into the meat and potatoes of this: is what's going on, who's the student, you know, what are you noticing? So you just kind of click what's going on, and then if there's any more detailed information, if you want to, you know, put more info than what is available on there, feel free to. And then just ask you some questions. You can ask to kind of stay involved. You can ask to just not be involved at all. You can let the Dean of Students know that I was the one who did this concern report, and you know, I would like you to tell the student that I did do it, because obviously if it's a coach and they're somebody that the student athlete trusts, then it might come off better than, you know, some random professor that they have that they don't really have a relationship with. So again, always on the employee portal. Again, what Bree said, if a student says something to you, I would advise them to fill it out as well, because again, the more information that the office has, the better they can handle the cases. So any questions about XU Act or the Exact team? So they meet every Friday, I believe, and they have a list of cases, and they go over it and determine if they think steps need to be taken or if not. So. It's kind of everybody. There's represented from athletics, from each college, I believe. So it's a nice thing to have, you know, and obviously for you guys, sometimes those conversations are a little uncomfortable, and this just gives you a way to kind of report what's going on without having to, you know, put yourself in a tough situation. So. Okay, everybody's favorite, lightning policy. All right, so we're who's sick of getting text messages? Anybody getting sick? Okay. So we are, for all intents and purposes, we are changing our lightning detection service. This is being handled by Nate and Susan. So once this gets rolling, which is hopefully this summer, I'm going to let Nate kind of play the point person with this because he's had the most experience with it. But we are looking at moving from iStrike to a system called Weather Sentry. It is an app. It's not a web page. Instead of getting 15 texts, you get some push notifications, and then you can always pull it up on the app, and it has a timer and everything. It's just a more streamlined system than what iStrike is. iStrike served us well for a while, but they're kind of behind the times in terms of the technology and how things go. They have a few glitches. So moving forward and trying to make it easier on you guys. I know Bree was at Macatiwa the other day, and it was storming, and she couldn't pull it up on her phone, so I was watching from the laptop in my office and texting her, and that's just not how it should be. It should be way easier for you guys to deal with this. It's something important. So hopefully moving forward with that, again, once that starts rolling, we'll get you guys back together and kind of show you how it works. So, but just generalities. Storms are going to be tracked. I think coaches and athletic trainers look at the forecast pretty much every day. If there is a chance for storms, it's going to be the same rings, 8, 12, and 20. If it's within 8, everything's shut down until it moves out of 8 for 30 minutes. 12 lets us know it's kind of on its way and get prepared to start picking things up off the field and moving inside. And then 20 obviously is a little bit far off, but gives us a good idea of when things might start moving in. So. The biggest thing we have seen with XUPD talking to us is obviously student athletes and coaches have locker rooms and places to go inside, but spectators are the biggest thing. With soccer and baseball, there's not really a designated area. So trying to help us get everybody into a covered area, which is not a dugout, not standing under an awning or anything like that. They have to be inside. So I think we opened up the gym in Schmidt a few times. O'Connor sometimes holds some people. So I'm just kind of helping us with that because, again, we're just trying to save ourselves from any kind of wrongdoing. So, and then, obviously, we kind of get together during a game, us as the athletic train staff, the coaching staffs, the athletic directors, and the officials kind of get together. And we'll get the all clear text, but if we think, hey, there's really no reason to go back out because another cell's on its way, so we kind of make that determination together when it comes to games. So, just this is an older picture, so it's a little bit more updated than this, but it is just an app. It looks very similar to iStrike. You do have a meteorologist that you can contact, so if you guys no, you want to be on the field or out, and we're not there, you can always talk with them in live chat, see what the weather's going to be like. And then, obviously, it's just such a more streamlined way of showing you how the lightning strikes are as opposed to those text messages that are this long that you have to decipher. So that's kind of what it's going to look like, a little bit more updated than this, but a lot cleaner than what we're used to. Heat policy. So we had an old graph on here. I pulled this one from the Corey Stringer Institute, which is out of UConn. We saw this this 2 weeks ago at the Big East Sports Medicine meeting down in Florida. A little bit more informative. There's not a whole lot of gray area. We don't have football, so it's a little bit different, but it does say, you know, this is how long practice should be, or we shouldn't be outside at all. And basically what we're going to start doing is taking temperatures outside the athletic trainer's will, and then make a determination on what we should do for practice. So obviously turf is going to be a little bit hotter. Tennis courts, I know, sometimes can get pretty hot. So we can move practice around, and obviously that's just maintaining clear communication with your athletic trainer more than anything about what the weather's going to do and what you guys plan on doing for practice. So hydration, obviously unlimited access to water. I wouldn't plan on holding it out. For the first 30 minutes of practice or whatever, everybody should have the ability to drink whenever they need to. If it is super hot, I would suggest organized water breaks. I think soccer for the NCAA is looking into water timeouts in games at some point. And then, obviously, the big thing right now is heat illness. So we kind of are developing better fine-tuning our protocol for heat illness and what we're doing. For soccer preseason, we have the tubs outside, and the athletic trainers are in charge of keeping those cold. because in the case that we do have to dunk somebody, then we have those available to us without having much to get through in terms of the hallway. And then if somebody does go down with some sort of heat illness, they will have to see one of our team physicians before they're fully cleared. And this isn't just for outdoor sports, this happens with indoor sports as well. Just if somebody is doing something harder than they're used to. I would also recommend that you guys, if you are gonna be outside or pushing really hard in the preseason, to get your student athletes outside as quick as possible this summer so they get acclimatized to the heat as opposed to doing indoor training all summer and then coming here to Cincinnati in August and go down with something bad. So just some tips and things like that. That's what we'll probably be using. We're looking at what we're kind of buying this summer. So stay tuned on all that. And obviously with the soccers, which is the most part with the preseason, I'll just talk with JJ and Connor about kind of what our policies are going to look like. Cold policy, I don't really like talking about it because there's no real clear-cut definition. You know, obviously just be smart if it's cold out, snowing, ice and rain, just from a slippery standpoint, but also a cold standpoint. If somebody is showing signs of any, you know, whether it's just chilblains or frostbite or anything like that, obviously we're just going to have to cancel practice and move everybody inside. So just be smart. There is no, I looked up a couple years ago and even the NCAA said if it's below zero on wind chill, they recommend not practicing outside, but there is no hard and fast rule that I could find. So again, something we're looking into. Yes? I think a lot. I mean, obviously if you're wet and it's cold out, you're gonna get more cold. So you have to just, and I know Doug, I think with tennis, you guys have a certain degree that is your cutoff point, right?
For matches.
Yeah. So, I think.
I think water exacerbates 32 times faster for hypothermia.
Yeah.
If you're wet and cold, you exacerbate hypothermia 32 times faster than just when you're wet. So water is the issue.
Yeah. I think that's where we get the most trouble is when it's cold out, but you also are out there for 2 hours and your entire clothes are wet, so you have nothing dry and nothing warm to have on. So what happened with you guys this week? I saw it was somewhat chilly. Okay.
But it was, I think, high of 38, 30 mile an hour wind gusts, and it rained the whole day.
That's
you're talking 4 or 5 hours of being out there.
Yeah.
It's not even close to what the
strikes. Right.
Classic.
So again, and Bree, I think that's what troubles me the most when we talk about the cold is that, again, the NCAA doesn't seem to have, it kind of varies sport by sport. I know. Right. Right. Sure. Yeah. They want to keep going. So again, I think the NCAA needs to do a better job of having a hard and fast temperature saying, we're either going to go outside or we're not going to go outside. But
I think they're a little more like sports, like,
sure.
Like out west, you know, because they're more part of the sport.
Yeah, yeah. And I don't know if you would do it sport by sport or what, but obviously if school is canceled due to snow, just be in contact with athletic directors and athletic trainers about what you're doing with practice. We used to have a rule that if it was school was canceled, we just wouldn't have practice, but that's not really the case anymore. So just be in contact with the athletic director of what's best to do. You just don't want a chance trying to get kids to campus and something bad happening on the road. So just some of the policies and procedures for the training room. We're trying to limit cell phones as much as possible, so if you can just reinforce that with us. Obviously, if someone's laying on the table just getting stim, we really don't care. But if they are doing active rehab, we would like them to be off their phone. So if you guys can just kind of help us with that and just remind them when they're in there, they need to treat it as a training session or a practice, and they need to be fully focused on what they're doing while they're in there. Please remind them that no Snapchat in the training room as well. It's a HIPAA violation. We get on kids all the time. But just, again, things that you guys can try to help us with. And then we tried this year. It's tough. But we're really going to try to enforce it next year is when we have physician and PT hours, we'd like those hours to be dedicated to those student athletes who are there to see the doctor or the physical therapist. So we're not having just craziness going on while we're trying to do that stuff. So if you guys could just remind them, or if somebody comes back and says, hey, I went to the training room, but they kicked me out, just understand that during those hours, we're focused on what's going on, not trying to take care of everybody else. So. Yes. Yeah. I mean, just off the top of my head, 12 to 1, Monday, Wednesday, somewhat Thursday is probably more 12 to 2, and then Friday is closer to 1 to 2. But they are listed outside on our sheet. So, just recovery. I know Bree wanted some of this information. She brought her team down to the training room after a weight training session one day and got more information. But just kind of what we think would best suit you guys for recovery and all that stuff. So before activity, we recommend the warm tub, obviously no ice, no cold tub, things like that. It doesn't make sense to chill the body part and then try to warm it back up again. If your kids are saying that they wanted grass in or cupping after practice and they didn't get it, please understand that it's more effective if we do it before rather than after. So we're trying to move everybody in that same mentality where we do open at 6 a.m. pretty much all year, and if they can't get there before practice, then we don't have too much sympathy for that. So if we have to be there, they can get there. So that's grassing and cupping. Obviously, we have stretch straps, the power plate as well. After activity, obviously, cold tub is a big thing in terms of athletics, but we have other things if kids don't like being cold, whether that's the Mark Pro. I know those are a big hit with the swimmers, the baseball team, anybody kind of with shoulders and but those are a big hit. Normatec boots, obviously a big hit with the runners. Foam rollers, again, you can always stretch. And then active recovery, whether it's just hopping on a bike or doing just some active movements after you get done, not getting done with practice and then going to sit in your dorm room for 4 hours. That's not really ideal. So, and that's it for us. All right, so any questions, comments, things that we could be doing better for you guys or your student athletes? No? Dave, anything to add?
As far as physicals are concerned,
oh, yeah.
Notified of your physicals and when they're going to be and things of that nature. But just want to emphasize to your student athletes, you know, making sure that they're working on getting their sickle cell tests and results. We'll have to have those. Making sure they get their immunization record from their physician. Those are just some of the things that they can start doing to make sure that they have them and ready to go. As a matter of fact, before they hit campus, so we'll have it all in their paper. They'll be getting their packets here shortly. So just tell them, you know, to be looking for those. We're trying to eliminate a lot more paper. You know, we're trying to do things more electronically now. So hopefully we'll be able to get them to them electronically and get the paperwork done, get it into us as soon as they possibly can. Questions and comments?
Yeah. So like Dave said with the packets, please try to get your student athletes to get them back by July 1 for those who are reporting in August. Just because if we get the packet and we see that someone has a history of some major orthopedic surgery, then it's our job to try to get those notes so when they see our team physicians, everybody's on the same page of what's going on. So try to encourage them to get back as quick as possible. We're tracking them. If they do move to jump forward, we'll be able to track them a little bit easier, and we can give you guys a heads up of who hasn't turned what in. But if you ever have questions, just email one of us or your athletic trainer, and we're happy to give you the answer on who still is missing things. Vaccinations to McGrath, they're requiring a new thing. Med Proctor, if you have any questions about that, just let me know, and I can point you in the right direction for those. And then just last things, communication. Obviously, I think we all are pretty good with our individual athletic trainers and our coaches about communicating, but just make sure you have that open line of communication if anything's going on, concerns, questions. And then Injury reports, everybody's kind of a little bit different on how they want them delivered. Just make sure that you're telling that to your athletic trainer so things are distributed correctly. We do have to be HIPAA compliant. We can't just send it out via email or text message or things like that. So it's either on the R drive or we hand you a paper copy. But if we hand you a paper copy, you got to make sure that it's in your possession or you shred it just because it is health information. Coach's packet is always on the R drive if you need more information. And that's it. So I'm going to turn it over. We've got our next two speakers. I believe Dr. Dixon is going to go first. All right. So Dr. Dixon, one of our TriHealth team physicians, she spoke last year kind of on biomechanical red flags and what you guys should look for. So she's going to kind of continue that talk and kind of open it up for you guys to ask her some questions. So.
Career day was amazing. I don't know. It doesn't really fit there. Thank you. Okay, so I, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Emily Dixon. I'm one of the sports medicine physicians. I am here on typically on Fridays from about 1 to 3 o'clock or so. So that's typically when you'll catch me. So I don't really have very many slides just because I wanted this to be more of an open-ended conversation with you all. So if you have questions, you can ask. So last year I talked about biomechanics and biomechanical red flags. And some of the stuff that we talked about last year was a valgus knee. So if you have an athlete that it's a volleyball player, every time they land, their knee bows in. When they're shooting a jump shot, their knees bowing and touch, that is a sign that they've got some weakness of their hip abductors and probably need to be seen the strength and conditioning coaches and the athletic trainers for a prehab program. We talked about dormant glute syndrome. This is incredibly common, or lazy butt syndrome as I like to call it. Very common in our runners, because when they're running straight ahead, they never use their hip abductors. So then they can get weakness, it makes their thigh roll in, causes knee problems, foot problems, all sorts of stuff. In our overhead athletes, we talked about whether this is volleyball, swimming, or baseball players. We talked about the glenohumeral internal rotational deficiency, where they get a really tight posterior shoulder, and then they tend to drop their elbow to swing, whether they're hitting a volleyball or anything else. And then we talked about the winging scapula. So that's when you look at a patient and an athlete, and their shoulder blade pops up. That's due to imbalance of the musculature of the posterior chain. And then we also talked about single leg landing. So this is probably more true on our volleyball players and our basketball players. If they're coming down all the time on one leg, puts you at risk for an ACL injury. So those are some of the kind of the biomechanical things we talked about last year. But this year I kind of want to talk about when we are doing our physicals, or we have an athlete that comes and gets injured, or perhaps there's a recruit that they want us to review the medical records. I kind of want to go through the process that both the physicians and the athletic trainers are looking at, okay? So the biggest thing that we like to look at is their past medical history, past surgical history, any family history, and then social stuff. Because we all know that the social stuff can affect these student athletes just as much as medical things can. So again, I only have like 4 slides, so because I really want this to be more of a discussion, and if you all have any questions about things. Anything I'm talking about does not necessarily mean you cannot recruit that athlete, but it may mean that if we're doing a chart review or something comes up when we're doing the physicals when they all come in the fall, this may mean that that athlete may need more time in the training room, perhaps may not be medically cleared to participate until we can work through it. And make sure that they're safe to participate. So these are all things that we kind of look about to think, and sorry, the formatting on this got a little bit weird. So past medical history, big red flags for us is congenital heart disease. So if we have an athlete that dad died at 33, dropped dead of a heart attack, that's a red flag for us, okay? In Division I sports, the highest rate of congenital heart abnormalities is in men or male basketball players, because they are tall, they're lanky, and primarily African American. That's the highest rate of congenital heart disease. So we're gonna be listening to their hearts and lungs. Some of these congenital heart diseases, unfortunately, we can't pick up with a stethoscope. So if they have an anomalous coronary artery that's going the wrong way, and then every time they run, it gets squished when they're running, that is not something we're gonna pick up on a physical exam necessarily, or an EKG. So that's why all of our male basketball players go and have a stress echo test at the beginning of the season, okay? But that's something that we're looking at, is a kid who's got a murmur or had a heart thing. Have they seen a cardiologist? Have they gotten their echo? That sort of thing. Anemia in our endurance athletes, if they have a low blood count or an iron deficiency anemia, that is something we're gonna look at. Women who menstruate and have heavy periods are gonna probably get a iron deficiency anemia. The other place we see that is our vegetarians and our vegans. So some of those nutritional things, that is something that if we have an athlete that's fatigued and not performing well, we may need to get a blood count up and then do a workup. Again, doesn't mean they may not be able to participate, but means we may need to do a little bit more work into that. Asthma and allergies. We have kids from all over the country, or all over the country across the Atlantic. Cincinnati is a little bit unique the way the Ohio Valley is, that we have really high rates of allergies. So you can have a kid who's never had allergies and then they're out running for cross country and now they can't breathe and they're short of breath and their nose is running. So those are the things that we're gonna look at just to kind of make sure that they know that there's issues. Yeah.
Have you ever heard of kids having negative reactions to just a daily allergy medicine?
Sometimes, I mean, it depends. Sometimes it can make them really tired. So it can fatigue them. Yeah, and that could be something that we could even start on like a nasal spray rather than a pill, like if it's mainly like nasal or if it's like eye allergies, that sort of thing. So that might just be something you send her and have her talk to one of the docs about it, yeah, to try where we can convince her, so rather than a coach. And this is kind of cut off, but another allergy that we worry about is obviously insects. Like, so if they have a bee anaphylaxis allergy, that's something we should probably know about and the athletic trainer should know about so that we have an EpiPen on them. Or if you all are traveling and they get stung by a bee, if they have an anaphylaxis, that the coaches, all the staff knows how to administer an EpiPen, okay? And I don't know what else I put down there because it cut off. So, so another big one that we see is eating disorders. This is more common in your endurance athletes. And a lot of times these eating disorders are not intentional. I put a lot on those slides. So a lot of times these kids, they're not necessarily specifically restricting their food. A lot of time it's unintentional. The best example I have of this is I had a high school runner who came in, leg pain. I ended up diagnosing him with a femur stress fracture. So this was a high school cross-country athlete. Femur stress fracture, that's a big deal. When we calculated his net nutritional things, how much calories he was taking in compared to how much he was burning when he was running, because they were running at the high school he was at, they were running 60 to 80 miles a week. He had a net, he was 2,000, like 2,400 calories less than what he should have been eating. And this was a good runner, but because they were running 60 to 80 miles a week, he wasn't even, and I asked the mom, like, is he, she's like, he eats like a horse. It's just one of those things that because he was running so much, he wasn't meeting that nutritional thing. So if we have an athlete that comes in with either, and sometimes we do get athletes that have restrictive nature, you know, it tends to be in more of our endurance athletes. But that's something we need to know about because we're gonna get them in with a sports nutritionist. We're gonna calculate what their needs are. Do you have an athlete? I know we have an athlete that's a vegan on men's basketball. So trying to figure out, making sure that they're getting those nutritional, making sure they're meeting their nutritional demands. Because I tell you what, when these kids go from high school and then they go to college, it's a total different ball game. So what they may have been, their behaviors they may have been doing, and now they're in the dorms, now they're eating in the cafeteria. The food isn't mom's food that they had at home. So you really got to make sure that we're matching all that. And sometimes these eating disorders, restrictive behavior, we hear some of this from teammates. The teammates will say, hey, we noticed Susie isn't eating as much, or we've noticed Johnny's doing this. So that's the sort of thing that we just want to kind of be aware of. Clotting and bleeding disorders. All Division I NCAA athletes are tested for sickle cell anemia or sickle cell trait. but we've had other ones in my experience that have a clotting disorder or a bleeding disorder. That's just something we need to be aware of, because if they do have an injury, we're gonna know to kind of put that higher up on our list. Single organs, this sounds weird, but occasionally happens. You have someone come in who only has one kidney, one testicle, one eye. Are they safe to participate in said sport? So those are just, again, things that we're gonna look at to make sure that whatever sport they're doing, we're protecting that single organ, because if they lose it, that's an issue, okay? Hypertension, I had an athlete, young kid, come in, blood pressure was crazy high every time we tested it. Had been on medicine, skinny little guy, doesn't look like someone should have high blood pressure. He's got high blood pressure. Over time, if he has high blood pressure, he's eventually start gonna stiffen his blood vessels and it's gonna affect his heart. So even though he's 17, 18, 19, that's something we need to be aware of and make sure that they're checking, okay? GI disorders. We see a ton of kids for medical for diarrhea, IBS, constipation. When I poop, it's bleeding, you know, that sort of stuff. So again, these are all things that if you have an athlete that's in season and they're going to the bathroom 8 times a day because their stool is soft, that's gonna affect their performance. It's gonna affect their hydration. So again, those are some things that we're gonna look at to try to figure out, possibly refer them to a specialist to get it worked out. Heat stroke and heat illness. We had an athlete this fall who had a pretty severe heat stroke. And had you know, some liver problems afterwards. So that is an athlete that after their core temperature gets so high, that can shut down their organs and cause a lot of problems. But a history of having a heat stroke in the past or heat illness, just being sensitive to heat, I pass out, I puke when it's really hot outside. Those are something we wanna know about, because if you all are gonna be in an environment where it's hot and doing practices, we may have to restrict that athlete a little bit. Maybe they're not running as much, or maybe they're doing something else while the rest of the team is doing something to protect that athlete. Because you will leave, if they have a heat stroke, you're gonna lose them for probably a season or more, okay? Irregular menstrual cycles in women. Doesn't matter what sport it is, if they have had normal periods and they are training and then they start to drop their periods, that is abnormal. Every single time. It is not normal for a female to drop their periods. That means that they are having too much imbalance in their hormonal system. It's usually related to their nutrition and overtraining. If they lose their periods, they're losing their good progesterone and estrogen, their hormones that help with bone health. Once they start dropping their periods, you're gonna start to see tissue breakdown, stress fractures, and other issues. And some of the kids will be on birth control, so they don't know they're dropping their periods. But if you have an athlete that's had normal periods, but when they're in season, they drop their periods, they're probably gonna break down. So that is something that we screen for. And to be honest, a lot of the girls, they're not gonna tell their male coaches that. So that is something that they're gonna need to have I see a lot of those too, like the female physician, they feel more comfortable talking to me about it. Okay, so that's just something that we screen them when they come in on their physicals with that. And some, especially some of our endurance athletes, they won't tell us the truth about that. And it's not like I can go and check them to make sure they're actually having their cycles, but that is something that we look at, okay? Psychiatric history. So the big thing with psychiatric history, this is definitely something that is sensitive. It's protected information. We may not be able to talk to coaches about it. For that student athlete's privacy. But just depression, anxiety, you know, they're moving to school, they're away from mom and dad, they're in a whole new environment, new stresses. We wanna know about that, just because if they get into a critical state, we wanna be able to step in on a behavioral health standpoint and find that stuff early. And then ADHD, I'm sure most of you are aware, if they're on ADHD meds, that those are banned medications, so we have to do proper paperwork with the NCAA to make sure that they can participate. And they are not allowed to participate on that medicine until we have it. And they are student athletes, right? They're students first, so we need to make sure that their academics are, so some of these kids will just stop taking their ADHD meds until the paperwork can get figured out, and then their school can kind of fall off the tracks. Okay, I already talked about food, insects, allergies again. I think Dr. O'Crowley already talked about concussions, but if we do have an athlete that has a history of like 7 concussions, we're gonna wanna know about that, because if they get hit in the head again, that could prolong their symptoms. And then epilepsy, seizure disorder. if I have an athlete that has a new onset seizure, totally different than someone who we know has a seizure disorder and has a seizure and is on medication. We're gonna work that up. If this is a new onset seizure, they're gonna be out a lot longer for that workup than someone who, with a known seizure disorder. And epilepsy, there's, I think the only sport technically that they can't do is scuba diving, right? For seizure disorder, that's like the only one that they're banned from. We don't have scuba diving, so we don't have to worry about that. Thyroid disorders. We have had athletes before who get a thyroid problem. The thyroid's a gland in your neck. Affects hormones, affects stress fractures, helps affects your energy levels. So if they have a low or high thyroid, they can go bananas on their metabolism. And we once had an athlete that was benched because they were being lazy, found out that had a very serious thyroid disorder, got the thyroid corrected, did fabulous. So that's just something that these are all things we're gonna look at. And then multiple stress fractures. This goes back to that whole nutrition, overuse disorders. If I have a cross country runner, track athlete, and they've had 5 stress fractures when they were in high school, I'm gonna look at their nutrition. I'm gonna have them see a sports nutritionist. We're gonna look at their menstrual cycles if it's a female. But males, there is a high level of stress fractures in male endurance athletes. So that is something that we're gonna kind of look at and make sure that we're doing everything. And then mono. How many of you guys had athletes that had mono and then are out for 21 days, right? If they've had mono in the past, that's good news for us because that means they're not gonna be held out. But if we have an athlete that gets diagnosed with acute mononucleosis, they are out for 21 days because of the risk of splenic rupture. They once did a study that showed that freshmen in college, they scanned them. 99% of them, if they had not been exposed to mono by the freshman year, they retested these kids their junior and senior years, 99% of them had turned positive for mono. So they will get mono in college if they haven't had it before. So, but if they get diagnosed with it, we have to hold them out for 21 days, okay? So that's a big one in the medical history, okay? So surgical history, this is a big thing that we're gonna look at. Anyone have questions about medical stuff or any concerns that you all could think of?
So 21 days for mono, that's
from the time of diagnosis.
Non-negotiable?
Non-negotiable. Splenic
rupture.
Don't matter. Your biggest risk of rupture of your spleen, it is in with 21 days, and it can happen just them sitting on the bench. It doesn't even have to be contact. Their spleen can rupture. It's actually from 21 days to 6 weeks, but we use the 21 day cutout, and that's mandated by NCAA. Yeah, and it's the splenic rupture can happen. Again, it doesn't even have to be like a contact. They can just be like sleeping in their bed and it'll go. Okay, so past surgical history. Again, none of these things that I'm talking about means that you cannot recruit this athlete. It just means that if we see they've had these things done, we are gonna be on them to be in working with the athletic trainers. And I'm a big believer in prehab rather than rehab. We want to prehab them so we prevent an injury. Okay, so we're talking about primary prevention. ACL, if we have had an athlete that's torn their ACL or had multiple revisions on that ACL. I tore it, the graft didn't take, I tore it again. Now I've had 3 ACL surgeries. Big red flag for us, we're gonna be on them, have them in working with the trainers, okay? Shoulders, baseball players, volleyball players, a labral repair, a capsular shift. If I see that someone's had a Laterger procedure, that's a bad one. That's when they've done bone grafting, they've shifted the bone around. I mean, that's a major procedure. So that is something that I want them in working with the physical therapist, regardless of if their shoulder doesn't hurt. We want to keep them on top of it because their risk of having osteoarthritis and problems with their cuff, their rotator cuff, is huge. Okay, ankles, tendon repairs, if they've had an Achilles tendon repair, peroneal tendon repair, posterior tibialis, those we're going to have them in doing one-legged balance stuff, sitting on a foam pad and turn around, putting them on a balance board, making sure that ankle is stable. Because if they've had those injuries, again, anytime you have an injury to a joint or a tendon, it's been surgically repaired, it is not your native joint or tendon anymore. It is not going to function like a normal joint or tendon unless you get on top of that, okay? And you all have seen when a kid tears their ACL, what happens to their quads after the first 3 weeks? Gone. Quads, gas rocks, everything's just sucked away, okay? So it is within 3 days of an injury, you're gonna start getting atrophy of the supporting muscles. So it takes, you know, 9 months to a year to come back from an ACL. So every day that you're weak and you've lost those muscles, it's gonna take 3 to 5 days to get those muscles back. So we are going to be really on top of them. These are kids, and as a coaching staff, are you seeing the athletic trainer? Are you doing your physical therapy? Working the dynamic strengthening into your warm-ups during practice to help these kids with injury prevention. A big one that we're starting to see more and more of in the last 5 years are hip procedures for a labral tear or something called FAI or femoral acetabular impingement. We think this is something that athletes develop through adolescence where they will actually get changes in their hip. And what femoral acetabular impingement is you either get a big spur on the socket or you get a big spur on the joint. And so when they flex, it'll pinch and it can catch their labrum, which is the rim of cartilage. Just like you have a labrum in your shoulder, you have a rim of cartilage, a labral in your hip, labrum in your hip. But if I've had a kid who's had a hip scope, whether they're a runner or a swimmer or a baseball player or whatever, that is certainly someone I'm gonna be checking the strength of their glute muscles, their quads, looking at their pelvis balance, low abdominal core is something we're gonna get on for them to work on to help stabilize that pelvis. Another one that I've seen quite a bit here are osteochondral defect repairs. So an osteochondral defect is like a pothole in the cartilage. So if you think about your asphalt, you got a big pothole in it. Our cartilage, we have a cap of cartilage on the end of our bones. If we've got a big old pothole in that cartilage, what do you think is gonna happen every time they run or do an impact activity on that joint? Okay, very common in the knee, and the most common place on the knee is on the inside of the femur, the lateral portion of the medial femoral condyle. And the ankle, sorry, I'm missing a common there. They can get on their talus, which is the bone here that helps our ankle rock up and down. And then in the elbow, very common in base on throwers, they can get it in a bone called the capitellum. So as they extend, they'll get catching and locking. So signs of an osteochondral defect is a joint that recurrently swells. So they'll get mechanical symptoms, catching, popping, and they'll just swell all the time. So they've had a procedure to either clean that out, or sometimes they have something called an Oates procedure, which is where they do a cartilage transplant and take a cap from a non-weight-bearing surface. So they take a donor piece and plug it in to where they, so kind of like filling in a pothole on the asphalt. But that is some, again, just like an ACL patient, that's someone we're gonna watch and wanna review and make sure that they're getting in and being seen. Kneecap. How many of you have had kids with loose kneecaps, that the kneecap shifts all the time or they have kneecap pain? It is constant. Probably 30% of my outpatient practice that comes in is anterior knee pain from kneecap pain. So patellar dislocation is where it actually pops all the way out and goes back in. When that happens, they can tear a little ligament called the MPFL, medial patellar femoral ligament, and sometimes that has to be repaired. Again, same thing as my ACL kid, that's someone I'm gonna be working on their glutes, working on their quads, working on their hamstring, working on overall stability. And then we get kids who may not have dislocated, but their kneecap shifts all the time. So they get recurrent subluxation and they just get a lot of irritation. And again, that's primarily like a biomechanical irritation. And again, it's really rehab, rehab, rehab. More and more, I'm starting to see athletes with herniated discs in their back and getting numbness, tingling down legs, very common in volleyball players, swimmers, anything with that hyperextension of the spine, soccer players, they go up to head the ball all the time. The gym, in the weightlifting room, deadlifts, those are good for business for herniated discs, okay? So just really making sure your kids are, these athletes are having really good form and proper positioning and making sure they're not, you know, being supervised. And then again, fracture repairs. You know, I slid into third base, wrecked my ankle, had plates put on both sides. Sometimes these athletes can have pain from the hardware, mechanical irritation from the hardware, and very common for them to get what we call post-traumatic arthritis. So anytime you've had an injury to a joint or a fracture near a joint line, whether it's an ACL or a broken bone, within 2 to 3 years, they can start to get osteoarthritic changes. So they can be 20 years old and have arthritis in their knee or elbow or wherever it may be. And then again, anyone who's had a cardiac or a vascular surgery, there's some very common congenital heart abnormalities called septal defects, atrial or ventricle, and sometimes they get a patch put on them. I mean, most of the time these kids are perfectly fine, but again, anytime we hear they've had a major surgery or I had stenting in my kidney or I had this done in my liver, I mean, that's just something we need to be aware of, especially if they're doing a contact sport, so we know whether or not they're safe. And we also, what we're looking for is medical clearance from that surgeon that's been documented in their chart to say, hey, this, you know, Bobby Joe Timmy Sue is safe to do this, okay? We recently, Dr. O'Cragley can speak to this, but we recently had an athlete that was looking to possibly come here who had a congenital heart abnormality of the heart, and they were cleared to run in their sport, but they needed to have an AED within 30 meters of them at all times to shock them in case they went down. So I was like, what are we gonna do? Follow them around on a golf cart or like put it on the backpack so if they go down, then we've got an AED there. So those are things that obviously that's a big red flag, like probably not appropriate for that athlete to come here for liability. But that's, so the big thing for us is we are going to be looking through their medical records, looking at their vaccine state. And again, sometimes some of the stuff doesn't come up until we see them at the physicals in the fall. And sometimes this is stuff that we may have to hold them out to make sure that they are safe to participate. And it could be there are times where we may not be able to tell you why because of patient privacy of why we're holding that student athlete out. I mean, it is up to the athlete. They feel comfortable talking to their coaches and all, but there are times where we will not be able to tell you the where, what, why, when. But our whole job, my whole job is to get athletes to play the sport that they love as long as they're doing it in a safe manner. Okay, and certainly some of this stuff, if we know they've got a history of a herniated disc and they come in with back pain or pain shooting down their leg, I'm gonna know better how to treat that than an athlete who's never had that before. You know, we had a ball player that came in, he'd had back pain off and on for 4 years, he would get into cyclical pain. Yeah, I'd rest for 4 weeks, it felt better, I got better. Then it'd come back, and then I'd rest for 4 weeks, I'd get better. I MRI'd him, he had 5 stress fractures in his spine. he lost a season. And this was coming out from high school. So again, and you all know you've signed a recruit and then they tear they're playing summer ball and they tear their ACL or they tear their labrum or you know something like that happens. So for us, it's just knowing the status of them, making sure we're doing right by the student athlete, and again, what Connor was talking about, the athlete injury reports and making sure everyone's aware, but there will be times where we may not be able to tell you why they're being held out, and that's for the student athlete's privacy. Questions? Or do you all have questions about any like concerns you might have or anything that we might think of? But you all understand where we're coming from with some of this, with looking at the history. And again, sometimes we get surprised on this, and we do screening for them. We do concussion screening. We do mental health screening when they come in, and that's something that we're going to look at as they go along. You know, has the athlete had a social thing? You know, mom passed away, had cancer, and passed away, and now they're away at school. And how are they dealing with that? So that those are all things. It's not just the sports injuries. It can be their medical stuff that we're going to look at and try to. Be aware of too. Again, and sometimes your own students and your team. So again, a lot of times, sometimes we get some of this insider information from teammates rather than the athlete themselves. And that's where you know trying to bring them in and taking a multidisciplinary approach at whatever they're dealing with to try to get them to feel better. Because our goal is for them to not break down. Okay, we don't want them to break down, and especially not in season. So, but if you know someone's had 3 shoulder repairs and they're a hitter, or you know someone's had an ACL tear, you know, and especially with female athletes, if they've had 1 ACL tear, they're 85% more likely to tear the other one, okay? So getting in and getting them in the prehab is incredibly important. Any questions? Any biomechanical questions? I know we went over that last year, but I know some of y'all weren't here. Good. All right, thank you.
Thanks, Doc. All right, next we're gonna have Scott just kind of go over with everybody just a CPR refresher course. Even if you are not up for recertification, just a good refresher course for you guys. And then just by a show of hands, how many are doing the actual course with Scott following this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6? Good. All right, cool.
So good morning, everybody. My name is Scott Bavero. I work for TriHealth, so you might have seen me around or see some of our other staff around. We do the medic service for any type of event, that for soccer, basketball, stuff like that. Also, I am a firefighter paramedic, so, and I've been doing this for about a little over 20 years. So when you guys have a class later on today, I'm going to throw some stories and stuff that I've seen that that is out there. So CPR is probably, I can honestly tell you, that's probably one of the most important things to learn, because a lot of people tend to not want to do CPR. They want to stay back because they're afraid they're going to get, they're going to hurt somebody, or so on. The big thing I want to point out is we encourage you to do the CPR, because we need you to start that process. Because I can assure you, when the fire department gets there and nothing's being done to that person, it is slim and hard to get somebody back from a cardiac arrest. Has anybody ever done CPR on somebody? Or used an AED on somebody, ever? It is a very scary and traumatic event. So, and we'll talk about that a little bit towards the end of the class. So the first thing you always want to do, and you may be on the sidelines or whatever, is you always want to make sure the scene is safe before you approach. You may walk into a room and you see somebody that literally collapsed. You don't know why he collapsed. You want to make sure that the scene is safe before you go and touch them. Now, one of the pictures that I show, and this is just one type of scenario. This has a person who is laying on the ground, but he has an extension cord that is underneath him. So we don't know if he's actually being electrocuted or he just grabbed his chest, went down, and died of a heart attack. We don't know that. So how would you fix that problem? What would you do? Anybody? So you have a guy laying on the ground on top of extension cord. You don't know if he's being actively electrocuted. How are you gonna turn that piece of equipment off? Yeah, go and find where it is. Simple, yes. But people are gonna rush in and they're gonna go immediately touch him. Now, if you would touch him with the palm of your hand, what is gonna happen? You're gonna be electrocuted. Are you going to be able to pull yourself off? Absolutely not, because as soon as you put your hand on him, your muscles are going to contract, and you are now on him. Not only do we got one person, now we got two, which is you. So always use the back of your hand, because if you go and touch him or touch her and they're about to be electrocuted, it's going to push you off, versus you put your hand and now you're stuck on there until somebody turns off that power, turns off that electricity. Tap the shoulder. Once you get there, the scene is safe, you approach and so on, there's no issues, tap them. Sir, ma'am, can you hear me? No response, who do we call? Call 911. If you're on campus, is it 911? Is that what the, So for the campus security or campus police. Then we want to look for signs of life really quick, coughing, moaning, breathing. This should take no less than 10 seconds. And then we're boom, no sign of life. We're starting CPR. We're getting right on that chest. Hands in the center of the chest. Elbows, fingers locked. Elbows are locked. Shoulders up over. If we're sitting on our heels, you're going to have a sore back because it is all upper body when it comes to doing chest compressions. We want to push down at least 2 inches. I'll show you what 2 inches looks like here on a video that I have. So this is hands-only CPR because if you don't have a barrier device, let's say you're at a mall and somebody goes down. Are you going to do mouth-to-mouth on somebody without a barrier device? I can assure you I will not. Because, and I'm not trying to get anybody gross or anything, but if you put your mouth over somebody else's mouth and breathe into it, all that turmoil of chest compressions, that air goes into where? The lungs and into the stomach. So all that turmoil, they're going to vomit. It's just a matter of when it's going to happen. And when it happens, I would hate for your mouth to be over somebody else's mouth and get a mouthful of vomit. It is disgusting. I totally get it. So what do you do in that situation if you don't have a barrier device? You're going to push hard and push fast in the center of a chest until help arrives. That is the recommendation for doing CPR. We'll talk about when we have a barrier device and what we want to do here. Just a couple more slides. So CPR hasn't changed from last year. It's 30 chest compressions, 2 ventilations, 5 times. It's actually 30 to 2, 5 times on everybody, the adult, child, and the infant. When you guys get certified today, we're not going over the infant and the child, but if anybody does have any little ones at home, I can kind of show you, but you will not get certified in the child and the infant. And it's a rate of 100 to 120 beats a minute. I'm not sure if last year was 120 when I taught you guys, but it's now 120. So 100 to 120, we're really moving on the chest. You're gonna work up a sweat. It is exertion, all exertion. So you can listen to a song, Lady Gaga, if it plays.
Got my phone queued up. What is it?
Oh, Bad Romance. That's a song that keeps you about 100, whoever my Lady Gaga fans are. So we want to keep up the beat. This is about 100 to 120 beats a minute. Or you could do the Staying Alive version of it. And I know everybody's seen Staying Alive. That's been a really, really big push. So that's a good beat to keep in your head. Now, I know everybody's favorite song here. I may not have to sing it, but if I do this, does everybody know what song this is? If anybody has little ones at home, this is Baby or Shark or Baby Shark. So my dun 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 dun, dun, dun. I'm not gonna sing it. Yep, there it is. This is everybody's favorite song because it is the most annoying song. But you can teach a kid to do CPR on this. Now I know everybody's gonna have this in your head for the rest of the day. But that is about 100 to 120 beats a minute to do CPR. So when somebody goes in cardiac arrest, take your phone out and play some music and work the beat. So this next slide I'm going to show you is, this is a real life event. It's somewhere in Asia. And I'm not endorsing, it's called the Lucas 2. I'm not endorsing this, but this is a gentleman that is in cardiac arrest. And what they're going to do is put a Lucas 2 machine. These are becoming very popular with fire departments and hospitals because it takes away somebody from doing CPR and it does perfect CPR. It actually pushes down 2.1 inches on the chest. So can we get that to play? if you go back out to the, I have one of those on the flash drive. It's CPR Lucas on the top. So what they're doing is they're putting this guy's in cardiac arrest. You see that yellow thing? That is a hard piece of equipment. We do CPR on a hard, firm surface. We push them into bed. What do they do? They sink into the bed. So they're putting this plunger on and trying to get it in the center of a chest where you put your hands. They're getting it set up. They put it down, get it set, and now they turn it on. And now it's doing chest compressions. That is 2 inches, 2.1 inches down on the chest. This is effective CPR on an average adult. Okay. Yes, sir. So ideally, what they should have been doing is doing CPR until they get it ready. Once they get it ready, they hook on, plug it, turn it on, and go, and go with it. Yes, but it may take like 10, 20 seconds to put that on there. So, but to do effective CPR, that is 2.1 inches down on the chest. So, it's when we put our hands and do chest compressions, you saw the size of that plunger. I mean, it circumferenced the entire chest almost, the chest bone. Where we put our hands is in the center of a chest, but our hands are localized with a palm. So when you do that and when you push down on a certain area, what do you think is going to happen? Something's going to give. And that means their ribs are going to break. You're going to feel that breaking of the ribs. I know it's disgusting. But what do you do? You got to keep going, got to, because you feel that chest, the ribs break. I know it's disgusting, and you're going to feel that shift constantly. But you got to keep going and survive. Hopefully that person can survive, because the key is if they survive it, they can go in and fix it. But they have to survive the cardiac incident first. Give them every opportunity to survive that cardiac arrest. There are numerous cases out there where people have survived a cardiac arrest, even athletes. I'm not sure if you guys have to have that just because of the age, but people who are under the age, I believe, of 19, the coaches have to take a course, not a course, but kind of watch a video and stuff. It's called the Lindsay Law. And I don't know if you guys ever heard of that or not, but it's been on the docket now for about 2 years now, and it's where any student who plays sports or any coach that plays sports, they have to watch this video and show, because we have athletes that go in cardiac arrest. They can be very, very, very fit, but they may have underlying medical problems. They may have cardiomyopathy. They may have electrolyte imbalance. We don't know. So where I work at, we actually had two students at a local high school. They were like 5-6 years apart that both went into cardiac arrest while doing their sport. Both survived and both had underlying medical problems that no one ever knew. So, but it was the coaching staff that saved the person. We don't save people, the fire department. Yes, we do, and we take them to the hospital, but you guys are the ones that are starting that heart and keeping that rhythm. So push hard, push fast until the medical team arrives. Or until the AD arrives. The airway, when we ventilate, so we do, now we have a pocket mask. And I'll show you what a pocket mask looks here in an AD here in a second. So a tongue is what? Yes, a muscle. So when we go in cardiac arrest, what do you think all muscles do? Relax. So it's actually going to slide over the opening of the airway. So we need to tilt that head back to displace that tongue and get the air in. So with a Berry device. Now, if this is my wife and my kids, I have no problem giving mouth to mouth to my wife and my kids, because I know them. Joe Schmo, who I have no idea who they are, and I surely don't want to get whatever they have. You have to assume anything coming out of that person is infectious, so you don't want to catch. Now, I can't sit there and tell you. I mean, if you want to put your mouth over somebody else's mouth, have at it. I mean, this guy, me, I will not do that. So we're going to tilt that head back and give two ventilations. So, and that's what a pocket mask looks like. So that's how we're going to give proper ventilations. We're going to tilt that head back and give ventilations. These are some of type of face mask or shields. This is actually a keychain. What you can buy it on Amazon, you can buy wherever. If you go on Amazon, you just pick a color. So that's a pocket mask because it covers the mouth and the nose, and this is a one-way valve, so air goes in, but nothing comes out. This type of device just goes into the mouth, so what are we going to have to do with the nose when we tilt the head back? We're going to pinch it. Why is that? In theory, air's going to come out, so we don't want the air to come out. So we're going to tilt that head back, and then we're going to ventilate. So this is an AED. So there are numerous ones out there. Does everybody know where the closest AED is here in the building? Or when you're at your sport, do you know where the closest AED is? Do the trainers have them? Why they're out there? I know when we're working as tri-health medics, we carry AEDs in our bag, so we have an AED. So if you don't know, always look to know where that AED is. You guys know what usually box that they're in? What color box? And it may not be here, just they may be anywhere. What? Red? They could be red, they could be white. They're marked AED or defibrillator. Look for them. They're just as popular as smoke detectors are. Not smoke detectors, fire extinguishers. Does everybody know where the nearest fire extinguisher here is in the building? Yeah. People overlook that. People overlook the AEDs as well. Know where the AED is. So how do you turn it on? So anybody have a wild guess on how you're going to turn that AED on? What button? There's that button. There's that button. Which one do you think you're going to push? Green button. Green usually means go. Also, it has this symbol on there. That's the international sign of power. You can be anywhere in the world, and you can use that AED. AED is just not strictly here in the United States. They're all over the place. So just because you speak a foreign language with that language of that country doesn't mean that you can't use it. They all work exactly the same way. You just may not understand it. I can assure you if it says you hear a beep, 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 like a metronome, what does that mean? What does that tell you? CPR. What happens if you hear the boop? Charging. So I'd not touch them. So, or you see the flashing lights or stuff like that. That means they're shock advised. So you can still use it even though that you're in a different country. So you're going to take the pads out. Some pads are universal, some are not. Out of these two slides, what do you think, which is the universal pad? The one on the left or the right? If you would take the pads out right now and see one of them, which one do you think is universal pad? I see the right. I see the left. The actual correct answer is the left, because you see that? That is area specific. These are universal because they can go either spots. All pads on the adult go right upper, left lower. Right upper. So if you see here, that is right upper. That's where that pad goes. Left lower is where that pad goes. Take an extra second before you put that pad on. Because I can assure you, and this happened to me probably about 3 or 4 years ago. I'm a swimmer. I swim on a competitive master's team across the river where I live at. So I usually swim before I go into work in the morning. And I got out of the pool, walked in the locker room, and there was a guy in cardiac arrest. They were doing CPR on him. I went and grabbed the AED, put it on, and I'm taking the pads out, and I'm shaking. Because at 6 in the morning, I am not mentally prepared to do my job. When I go into work, I know I'm mentally prepared to be kind of what can be thrown at me. But at 6 in the morning, getting out of the pool, I am not mentally prepared to do my job. So I'm nervous. You're going to be nervous. That is okay to be nervous. Take a deep breath. That's all you need to do, and look at the picture and apply the picture. Because if you put these on backwards, they may not work properly. and we want it to work properly. And if you take them off, they may not stick. So give that effort, give that extra second, take a deep breath, and apply the pads, right upper, left lower. These pads here on the left can go either spot. Just look at the picture. If there's pictures this way on both, up, right upper, left lower, then they're universal. But if it's just saying right here, that is area specific. So we're going to sit, let it analyze. That is all the room that you need. Where's that AED, by the way? It's at the head on what side? Your side. Because if it's on this side and there's a shock advised, what are you going to have to do? You're going to have to reach over that person. And some people wear lanyards. People wear large jewelry. They may touch them by accident, not thinking. And when you push that shock button, those still put out 360 joules. It's enough to knock you on your ass and put you in cardiac arrest. You have to respect it. Keep it on your side. It's out of the way at the head. And you still do CPR. Don't touch the person while it's analyzing. It says no shock advised. Do CPR. We're going to do what? CPR. If it says shock advised, we're going to let it rev up. And then what button are we going to push? The big flashing button. Make sure everybody's clear. You're clear. I'm clear. We're all clear before we press the button. No shock advised. Start CPR. The only thing that's going to tell you is start CPR, no shock advised, or check patient. That's it. That's all it's going to tell you. It is so simple that it is designed for people who have never touched it before. Bob Huggins, I know you guys probably heard the story before. He went to cardiac arrest at an airport. That person who used it on Bob Huggins never touched an AED in his life, ever, and remembered where it was and followed the prompts of what it told him to do. That's all you got to do. So with that, after CPR, there's an AED kit. So when you get that AED, so if you bring the AED with you, we want you to put the AED on first and then follow the prompts, because we as adults need the shock. We kids, infants, yes, you can still put the AED on them, but typically they're not going to use the AED because kids go on cardiac arrest because of airway issues. For us as adults, it's genetics. Because of maybe we've inherited some from mom or dad. Do people remember Bob Harper from The Biggest Loser? Anybody ever watch that? Well, Bob Harper, he was a trainer on The Biggest Loser. And after The Biggest Loser off the air, he was still a big CrossFit. And I'm assuming everybody here knows somewhat what CrossFit is. So if you don't know, CrossFit is a very exertion type of exercise, usually 20 minutes or so of full exertion. Most people fall on the floor because they're exhausted. He fell on the floor because he was in cardiac arrest, because his mom, about the same age, died of a heart attack. Genetics plays a huge part of her body makeup. He's only 50 years old, very fit guy, probably 2% body fat, very, very, very fit guy, and still he went to cardiac arrest. So airway. Put that AED on first. In that kit, we have a pocket mask to use to give ventilations. Then we have a pair of scissors. What are the scissors for? Cut the clothes off. As for the women, because of the bra, the underwire, we need to cut the bra off as well, just because it's so we can put the pads on. At this point, make sure that we scare people around, and because people are taking their phones out. Unfortunately, they're not calling 911. They're taking pictures or doing videos so they can post it on YouTube an hour later. So make sure you just kind of scare people around. Then we got gloves. And what do you think we got a razor for? Shave the chest. Some guys have extremely hairy chests. And if you would put the pad on that hairy chest, what you're actually doing is sticking it to the chest hair and not to the skin. And when you see that there's a shock advised, because it actually comes up, you're going to see a spark go across the chest. We don't want that to happen. So you need to take a razor, shave it just as best as possible. Some places have duct tape. And what they're doing is you take a piece of duct tape, rip it off, put it on there, and rip it off. And I can assure you, if they come off the floor, they are not in cardiac arrest. because that chest hair is being pulled out. But that is why we have duct tape or a razor in the AED kits. Puddles, can you use the AED like on pool deck or outside in the parking lot with a fresh rain? Absolutely. We can use it on a pool deck. There's been known instances where swimmers, there was just an article about a year and a half ago, he wasn't a collegiate, he was a high school swimmer, was swimming in the pool, getting ready to do his flip turn, and kind of went and hit his head, just kind of glided into the wall. And the coaches were like, come on. And then they realized that something was wrong, got him out of the pool, put him on the pool deck, dried him off, used the AED and shocked him and got him back. So you can use it on the pool deck. You can use it out here in the parking lot. As long as it's a fresh rain, as long as you walk up and you don't hear splash, splash, that is too much water. We need to roll them out into somewhat of a damp area. But after a fresh rain, if it's sprinkling, I would still use it. If it's pouring down rain, I would stay away from that. I would just do CPR until we were able to get there. Pacemakers. This is what a pacemaker looks like if you've never seen one before. 99% of the time, the pacemakers are right here on the left-hand side. Every once in a while, they have to move it to the right. If that is the case where they move it to the right, don't put the pad on top of it, just below the AED, or just below the pacemaker. Not on top, but just be below. One last thing before questions is medicine patches. A lot of people have medicine patches that they use. A lot of people, I don't know where they tell them to put them, but people put them in convenience for them. Because when they put a medicine patch on, the three spots that you need to be concerned about is right upper where the pad goes, center of the chest where your hands go, and left lower where the other pad goes. Because I can assure you, if they have a medicine patch over here and you just rip it off and then put your hands on there, that gel that is on your hand now is the medicine. So it will absorb through your skin. So make sure you take that medicine patch off with a barrier device, some type of glove, their clothing, whatever. Pull that off, wipe it off, and then you can start. Any questions over what this is more of a demo today. We'll kind of get a little bit more in depth later on today. But any questions for me? Okay. All right. Thank you.